Meeting with executive session. I'll come back to that in a minute, but let's do our Pledge of Allegiance first, please. Okay, as I mentioned, we began the meeting this evening in executive session. In executive session, we discussed contract negotiations, litigation, and real property, as well as we approved some executive session minutes from prior weeks. Also in executive session, we reached an agreement with the dispatch union for police and fire here in Hopkinton. So with that, the chair will seek a motion to ratify the contract for the dispatch union effective immediately.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on the table for the to ratify the contract. Mr. Kamala, any comments on the motion?
Yes, for clarity, the term of the contract is July 1, 2015 to June 30th, 2016.
Okay, thank you. Any discussion by the board on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. So we're now under contract with our colleagues in the dispatch union. Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda. Oh, I'm sorry, one other comment if I could, please. Under item number 12 in our agenda this evening, the police chief is going to address the selectmen and discuss the alcohol compliance check operation along with two additional items. Those two items recently came to light, and the chief would like to bring those to our attention tonight as well, so I'm adding them to the agenda under his report. Those items are specific to the HCA as well as the last plate served a report that came out from the state. Is that correct, Chief Lee?
That's correct.
Thank you. So, just so everyone's aware. With that, public session, public forum. Is anyone here that would like to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding their town government to the Board of Selectmen? Mr. Kistner, at the podium, please, if you could introduce yourself.
Well, my name is Clifford Kistner. I live at 86 West Main Street in Hopkinton. It's for later on in the agenda that I noticed the alcohol liquor license for Lumber Street. I would like to make an address at that particular time when that comes up.
Okay, so we're going to be holding a public hearing for item number 9, which is a all alcohol liquor license request from the Hopkinton Tennis and Swim Club. That's a public hearing, so at that time, there will be an opportunity for the public to address the board.
Terrific.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? With that, we'll move right along. We have two, great opportunities to showcase the amazing work that our first responders in Hopkinton do. You know, we hear about first responders across America, unfortunately, all too often these days, and the amazing work they do elsewhere around the country. But we have great first responders here. I don't know if I should say I've had the pleasure, but I have seen them in action personally. They do amazing work, and I'm glad we're going to take some time this evening to recognize their hard work and dedication to the town of Hopkinton. Chief Lee.
Pete was on a call. Excuse his tardiness. Last week, on June 9th, the Municipal Training Council recognized about 100 offices throughout the state, and we had the honor and the privilege to having 5 offices be represented for their life-saving efforts. two of the offices received two citations. Now, this was the most in the state, and we're talking about every police department in the state, including Boston. And this is a direct credit to the amount of work and training that goes in. We got a unique situation where all our offices are EMTs, which you don't really see on most police departments. There's a lot involved in it, and they're certainly up for the task. In my 26 years of a city police department where we weren't EMT trained, we've never had many opportunities to save lives like we've seen here. And this is just a one-year period. As a matter of fact, we had a Narcan save the other night that I'm sure we'll be presenting soon. So let me start off with, on October 23rd, 2015, Officer Schofield was dispatched to a local address for a report of an unresponsive 17-year-old male. Upon arrival, the man's father had already connected an AED to his son and began CPR. Officer Schofield assisted with CPR, and a few minutes later, the victim started to move and regain consciousness. It was later learned that the victim had a history of seizures. The quick actions of Officer Schofield in assisting obviously assisted in saving this youth's life. Congratulations, Officer Schofield. Now, at the ceremony, they all received a pin as well as a citation. I believe they're all donning their pins tonight.
Which pin is it?
I could go through all, or did you like to address Mr. Chair?
Yeah, why don't we do all of them, and then we can
okay.
Say it.
On February 9th, Sergeant Aaron O'Neill, newly appointed Sergeant O'Neill, and Officer Peter Booth were both dispatched for an unresponsive female. Upon arrival at the resident's home, they found a female unconscious, unresponsive, with cyanosis of her lips, lying on the living room floor. The officers quickly assessed the female and discovered she was pulseless. They quickly initiated CPR and applied an AED to the victim. A shock was administered to the victim, and they continued CPR. The Hopkinton Fire Department arrived on and continued care. While on scene, the victim regained a pulse and started to breathing on her own. This again truly demonstrates that good CPR and early defibrillation makes a difference. Congratulations, Sergeant O'Neill and Sergeant Peter Booth. I'll have to give a shout out to our firemen there, too. On February 20th, again, Sergeant O'Neill and Arthur Schofield were dispatched to a local residence for a possible overdose. On their arrival, they found an unconscious victim in the upstairs bathroom, apparently suffering from a heroin overdose. Sergeant O'Neill administered a single dose of Narcan without any change in the victim's condition. Officer Schofield dragged the victim out of the bathroom into the bedroom. Officer Schofield reassessed the victim and discovered she was now pulseless. Officer Schofield quickly began CPR. The Hopkinton Fire Department arrived on scene and continued care. The victim was later transported to the hospital where she made a full recovery. Congratulations again, Sergeant O'Neill and Officer Schofield. On March 24th, Officer William Detective Brashad, was dispatched to a local restaurant. Upon his arrival, Officer Brashad was directed to the dining room where he found a man attempting to perform the Heimlich maneuver on a choking woman. The woman suddenly sat down and became unconscious. Officer Brashad quickly picked her up and performed three abdominal thrusts, causing the large food to become dislodged. Officer Brashad placed the victim on her side as she was still unconscious but now breathing. The victim later regained consciousness. The quick actions of Officer Brashad, without a doubt, saved this woman's life. Congratulations. The last one is Officer John Moran. Unfortunately, he couldn't be here tonight with a previous engagement. But on April 24th, Officer Moran responded to a mutual aid request to the town of Southborough for a report of a two-car MVA crash with serious injuries. On Officer Moran's arrival, he found one motor vehicle described as a pickup truck on its side leaking gas. The victim was bleeding profusely, was pinned in the motor vehicle with the door jammed shut. Officer Moran broke the window to gain access to the victim. Officer Moran was then, with discard to his own safety, reached into the motor vehicle to provide care for the victim and to stop the bleeding. The roof of the motor vehicle was later removed, and Officer Moran entered the motor vehicle to continue care for the victim who was suffering extensive head trauma. Officer Moran encouraged the victim to remain conscious. He stopped the bleeding and provided emotional support. The victim was later removed from the vehicle and was transported to the hospital. Congratulations, Officer Moran, who, as I said before, couldn't be here. But just, you hear these stories, it's just, it's unbelievable that this has occurred in a year's time with these fine officers and the magnitude of the saves. So it was an honor for me to hand out those certificates to these officers and attend the ceremony. And I'm sure that, Mr. Chair, through the chair, that you are very happy with these officers as well.
You know, it's, we think we do important work here in town hall at the Board of Selectmen level, helping sort of guide the community in the right direction. But what you just described there, you know, what we do pales in comparison to what you guys do every day. I'm in awe of how you guys go about your work, how you get it done, and the lives that you save. I mean, it's just incredible. It gives me chills. So I'm honored to be with you tonight, and I'm thrilled that you've been so successful in your careers. And I know your colleagues feel the same way, and I'm sure they're doing similar acts of bravery and heroics out there every day. And it's just amazing. It's amazing. Thank you so much, Mrs. Wright.
What a wonderful display of heroism and compassion and skill.
Mike.
Again, this is just a wonderful display of the compassion and the bravery and the skill of our first responders. We are such a fortunate community to have this kind of a force. And as Mr. Hurst said, for all the things you hear in the news, I can't thank you enough, and I'm so grateful for the wonderful relations and appreciation that our community has for our wonderful police force. Thank you very much.
Well, I echo the sentiment that that these two said. However, I don't find it to be a surprise that you guys are up here doing this. You guys are selfless. You do it every day. You've done it for years. I've known most of you guys for a long time, and it's not a shock at all. It's awesome. I also get chills thinking about this, and I'm excited, and I'm proud to have you guys represent us and keeping everything safe. Keep doing it. Awesome. Congratulations.
Yeah, and the other thing, the only other point I would make is, Chief, please keep bringing these to our attention. Let us know. I mean, we live in little old Hopkinton. We all know it, right? You guys cruise around, see it every day, and everyone just loves how quiet it is. It's not that quiet. You guys deal with some serious stuff out there, and the community doesn't always hear about it. So let us know so we can thank those responsible and help our community understand the hard work that you guys do day in and day out. Okay? Great. Thanks very much, guys. Great job. Well done. Okay, with that, and I'm not sure how we top that, Fire Chief Slammon is going to come and join us, and we're going to recognize one of his team members, William Krause. Chief Slammon.
Thank you very much, sir. Again, my hat's off to the officers. It's proud for public safety to see the results like that, so nice job, gentlemen. I'm honored here today to speak about the fire service as a proud profession, and one of our customs is to demonstrate this pride with a ceremonial pinning of our new officers. So tonight, it's with great pride that I introduced to you our newest promotion. First, I'd like to mention that he's a family man. His wife, Jill, and his Johnny and Christina, his kids, they're just wonderful. They support us at every event. And it's just, in the fire service, you know, you have your family and then you have your family at the station. So it's really neat that they deliver that. Bill was appointed as a firefighter back in August 2009. Since then, I would characterize Bill as reliable and dependable, accountable and credible, trustworthy and respected, a team player. He goes to classes and attends seminars. He's a go-to guy. People can depend on Bill. He always shows up. He wears the uniform with pride, takes care of the reputation of a firefighter, treats people like their family, makes a difference every chance he has. Bill's got credentials. He's certified as a fire officer, an incident safety officer, fire instructor, and hazardous materials operational level. So the success of an organization greatly depends on its leaders. The quality that Bill brings to the organization gives me the highest level of confidence when I selected him as our newest lieutenant. So congratulations.
Thank you.
Ceremonial-wise, I'd like to allow Bill to have his son give him his pinning, and then maybe you can make some comments. That sound okay?
That'd be great. Thanks.
So, Johnny, if we can bring you forward. I think I'm going to have you get right in front of the podium there, my friend.
Congratulations, great job.
I offer you Lieutenant Krause.
Bill, congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming tonight, and welcome to the new role. Now, I have a question. Your son has a uniform on as well. Can you help us understand that a little bit?
Well, he's working as an EMT now for Community Ambulance over in the town of Milford. He's kind of following in my footsteps. He's been to school. He's got his fire science degree. He's working on his paramedic degree now, about halfway through the program. So he's heading in the same direction I am.
Excellent. Great.
So he's doing very well.
Excellent. Yeah. Fantastic. Mr. Testone.
Well, I've seen Mr. Krause in action. I've seen him work, and he is the epitome of someone that you want here being promoted. He's calm, level-headed. He's not... He doesn't talk about himself. He doesn't do it for the show. You have some people, and I'm not saying the fire service, but in general, some people are more sizzle than they are steak. This guy's all steak, no sizzle. He doesn't want to talk about himself.
You're describing politicians now.
You're right.
Hungry.
You're right. So as I said about the police officers, it's not a surprise to see Billy here. It's awesome. I'm glad, and it's nice to see the department continue its forward movement, and I know that that you'll do nothing but help that. Congratulations from
the
heart.
Thank you.
Mrs. Wright.
Well, I hope you guys never have to come to my house, but if you do, I hope you'll be there, Lieutenant Krause.
Thank you.
And thank you so much for your fine service, and congratulations for your well-deserved promotion. We're proud of you and grateful to you.
Thanks again.
It's interesting you mentioned that you hope they don't have to come to your house. I don't remember who came to my house. The whole thing is like a blur to me. But it was amazing. I felt so at ease when the Hopkinton Fire Department arrived. I was a mess. I had a little hose. I'm spraying it on a car full of gas and oil and everything. Things are blowing up everywhere. It was a mess. And they're like, put that down, get out of the way. But they just showed up and they just took over. And my heart rate just dropped. And I had this incredible sense of calm come over me when the Hopkinton Fire Department showed up. And to you and all of your colleagues, I've said it a million times, thank you. To see you get promoted as part of your career path and process and growth here in Hopkinton, I think is great. I love how we do this internally, and I hope we can continue to do it. You're a great example to your family and to the community, and we're glad to have you on board. And keep doing what you do.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much. Thanks for coming. Mr. Kamala, he's over here waving his hand.
Exactly. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to take this opportunity to congratulate the chief and the department for a successful hiring process, due in large part, and Bill, you need to know this, through your own efforts. I understand from members of the hiring committee that you did a fantastic job.
Thank you.
Also, I want to thank the fire union staff. They were part of the process, collaborating with the chief, making this happen. And most importantly, also thank the role of, acknowledge the role of the HR department. They were a business partner to the chief. Again, congratulations, and wish you the best of luck.
Thanks.
This has been a great way to start our meeting tonight, guys. Thank you all for coming. Our first responders are as good as any first responders in America, and we're lucky to have all of you. Thank you.
Agreed.
Yep. That guy, look, that guy. So Bill Miller did come to my house. I remember him. I just saw him standing back there with that big smile. He had a smile on when my house was burning, too. So, good to see you, Bill.
Thank you, guys. Congratulations.
Okay. We need to move on to some other business here. Item number three on the agenda, we have the consent agenda. The consent agenda is very short this evening. We have some minutes from June 7th, 2016. Chair will entertain a motion to approve those minutes.
So moved. Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so the minutes pass unanimously. Item number four on the agenda is back to the fire chief. Chief Slamon is going to give us a brief update on the ladder truck purchase process. If we all recall, on or during town meeting 2016, town meeting authorized through one of the articles the fire chief to purchase a used ladder truck, not to exceed a certain sum of money, and the fire chief, following town meeting, was dispatched to go get it done, and he's here tonight to report where he is and to ask for our support. Mr. Slamon.
Thank you very much, there, Chairman Herr. We're at the final stages, so tonight I can report to you that we have agreement in hand, ready to go with the Cutlerville, Michigan, who has a, I would say, after 8 to 10 weeks of diligent searching and tremendous help to, from firefighter Rich Cochran, who has some real expertise here that's kind of made it, took the weight off of me to try to understand every aspect of a quality ladder truck. We actually went to New York and flew out and inspected one we really liked, but it was a little too long to fit in our building. And this one in Michigan, after Rich's flight, he didn't want to go to Michigan, but we hired and inspected it. It's passed several inspections. It's a quality vehicle. Doing some of our online research and making some calls to some friends around in the area, we kind of confirmed that it has some real quality. So we're at the point now where everything is in place to literally send a mailing off tomorrow if you're good with the purchase. So I'm really excited about the quality of this vehicle. There's a little risk with every used piece of equipment, but this really seems like our homework paid off.
And the article that town meeting approved was for what amount?
$125,000 was set aside for the ladder truck.
And how much did we negotiate to purchase this truck for?
$115,000.
So we're $10,000 under the authorization by town meeting.
Yeah, the $10,000, we went on purpose a little low. We have some work we have to do to finish the job of making it in service. So.
Okay,
$115,000 was kind of a hard top for us on the price. We were fortunate that they were willing to accept that offer after some negotiation. So that was our hard top. We need $10,000 just to the baseline of getting it in service. Some simple things like some equipment changes, painting, labeling, things like that.
Got it. Okay. Mr. Tedstone.
I know that these guys have done a lot of work on it. I trust the judgment of I know Firefighter Cochran very well, I know Chief Slamon very well, and I trust their judgment. I would be willing to assist the transport back from Michigan if if need be, but no, I think that's great, and congratulations, thank you for keeping it under budget, and it's nice, this will carry us up to the next level.
That would be a pretty cool road trip.
Let's do it. We can make a motion.
Mrs. Wright.
No, I think it's great, especially with the way the town's growing, bringing in some multi unit housing like Hopkinton Muse and the Wood Partners development, I think it's a really good item for the town to have. I just wonder, do we have a bay to store it in our current facility? Is another truck going to be retired, or how is the housing of that going to work?
Well, that's a great question. We did two downsizing moves. We got rid of an engine that was stored in Woodville. We got rid of an ambulance that was used for communications, and then with a little bit of jock in, it frees up a bay, and that's why I could have done something with the larger truck, but it would have been too crowded. This will fit nicely.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
So the chair will entertain a motion to affirm the fire chief's decision to purchase the ladder truck as stipulated in the town meeting article.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Kamal, are you okay with that motion?
Yes.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Okay, Chief, go get your truck.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the support.
Okay, we have a public hearing at 7:15. We've got 1 minute before that begins. We're not really going to be able to tackle anything in advance of that. So this public hearing, we'll vote to open it. It's to move or to underground some electric service on Lumber Street.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Kamal.
How about if you take item number 6, board resignations?
I think that might drag on a little bit because we're going to have to talk about a couple of plans to fill those positions.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so with that, it's 7:15. The chair will entertain a motion to open the public hearing where the Board of Selectmen will consider granting permission to Eversource Energy Company to construct conduit under Lumber Street for the purpose of providing electric service. Someone want to make that motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
So the public hearing is now open to grant permission to underground some electric service by Eversource. So what will happen here is we'll hear from the proponent, and then the Board of Selectmen will have an opportunity to ask some questions. The town manager and our director of land use and planning can jump in, and then we'll go out to the public if anyone has any comments. And once we sort of go through that process and we think we have all the information, we'll close the public hearing, and then we'll deliberate and go from there. So with that, I'll turn it over to the representative from the Eversource, if she could identify herself and present her.
Christine Crosby, Eversource Energy.
Hi, Christine.
Hi. We are requesting permission for grant a location for approximately 42 feet of conduit at pole 35 over 9 Lumber Street. And the purpose of the installation of conduit will be to provide the new underground electric service to the residential development being under construction now out there.
Okay. I'm sorry. Did you say the size of the conduits?
The size? Should be right on the plan.
Just curious, I guess. That's what I do.
2 4-inch conduits.
4-inch, okay. It's going to be PVC?
PVC, yeah.
Okay. How deep will it be?
Approximately 3 feet.
3 feet?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Mr. Tedstone, any questions?
I don't.
Mrs. Wright?
Well, I know there has been concern that this not happen or not be in conflict with the road resurfacing, and I think we have a condition we can put in if the road has already been paved. But do you have any idea of your projected timing for this and whether that will be in advance of the road resurfacing?
Well, they're looking to do the installation as quickly as possible. And I was out there, and I did see the developer has, you know, already done their trench on private property. Up to the point where we would pick up. So it seems like it's really kind of ready to go to construction, but I do know that they will do directional drilling if that's the case, that if the road's already been paved.
Right. Okay.
It's just a tunnel underneath.
No, right, no, I know that's a condition we want to put in it, but I just wonder if that was going to be avoided maybe.
Okay.
No.
Okay. Anything else you want to share with the board? All set, Mr. Kamalo, any questions?
Yes. Could you please be more specific in terms of your schedule?
The schedule?
Yes.
Well, once this gets approved, it'll go back into the construction queue, and they'll do a dig safe. They'll call dig safe, and they're looking to get out there as quickly as they can. I don't really know the exact schedule.
Okay, thank you. I raised the issue because in prior projects, the issue of at least receiving from Eversource specific schedules has been problematic. And I just want to make sure that the town's position regarding the need for much more definitive information on when things are going to be done, I think is imperative.
In general or just specifically for this or?
In general and also specific to this.
Okay. All right. Well, I can find out. I'll go in when I go into the office tomorrow. I'll find out what the plan is as far as the scheduling goes. I'll get back to you on it.
Thank you.
Does our director of operations have any questions or thoughts?
I just wanted to mention that the reason why they're going underground under Lumber Street is because the boards that approved the Lumber Street overall master plan special permit and the comprehensive permit was that they go underground and avoid the installation of new poles along the town roads for appearance purposes. So they're doing as directed by the land use boards. And I did propose the condition after speaking with John Westerling, and so he's reviewed that condition and he's acceptable with that.
And that condition does not necessarily have to be in our motion. We just approve doing it, and then those conditions will follow based on the other permits.
That in your motion that you approve it with that condition, which will attach to what they
you want us to include it? Okay, got it. Okay. All right, so we're good on sort of the professional side here. So this is a public hearing. Do we have any abutters? We always go to abutters first, right? I kind of forgot that the first couple meetings. Do we have any abutters that were notified that might be interested in commenting on this electric service action? Seeing no abutters come to the microphone, do we have any residents of Hopkinton interested in offering an opinion or thoughts or questions on this? Seeing none, we have a non-controversial issue in front of us. So I think with that, the chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing for the undergrounding of the electric service on Lumber Street.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on the motion? Mr. Kamal, are you okay with us closing the public hearing?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, the hearing is now closed. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll take a couple minutes here and talk about it and hopefully have a decision for you shortly. Mrs. Wright, any thoughts on undergrounding the electric service?
I don't have any thoughts except that, you know, we include the condition that Mrs. Lazarus has suggested to make sure that if it's done after the road's been resurfaced, that there's no digging up of the new pavement.
Okay. Mr. Tedston.
Yeah, same thing. I defer to Mrs. Lazarus. Also, if there's ever they should kind of plan now for any type of possible need for expansion and maybe go greater than if there's a possibility of more need for electric service or whatever, to make sure that it's all kind of, it can all go into one rather than have to come back and reopen the road.
4-inch conduits typically are the standard large installation that you would do. You can go 5 or 6, but then you're getting into mega size projects like skyscrapers and things like that.
We do not want that.
Yeah, I think that the 4-inch should suffice for future capacity.
Yep. I defer to the
really
experts.
Eversource's call. But good thought. Being that I used to be in the selling of conduit business, yep. The more conduit, the better, right?
Yep.
That's my motto. Okay. So, does someone want to make a motion?
Sure. I will move that the selectmen grant permission to Eversource Energy to construct conduit under Lumber Street for the purpose of providing electric service, subject to the following condition: that the area of Lumber Street where the conduit is to be installed is current, excuse me, subject to the following condition. If the conduit is not installed prior to the resurfacing of Lumber Street, directional drilling shall be employed and the pavement of Lumber Street shall not be disturbed.
Second.
Mr. Kamalo, good with that motion?
Perfect.
Mrs. Lazarus, good? Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. So you're all set for your undergrounding of the service.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good night. Okay. Now we can go back to the regular agenda. Let me just look forward here a little bit to make sure we time things out properly. We've got another public hearing at 8 o'clock for a liquor license. And then we've got 8:30 to 9:20, 50 minutes set aside for a public hearing on our trash discussion. We're not going to vote that tonight, but we're going to listen, okay? And that's it as far as public hearings, right? So we can move through some other stuff between now and then. Okay. Item number 6 on the agenda, the Board of Selectmen will consider accepting the following resignations. Nupa Patel from the Zoning Board of Appeals, Kurt Fliegroff from the Cable Advisory Committee, Joyce Brousseau and Carol Walsh from the Board of Registrars of Voters, and Paul Winchman from the Board of Health. Mr. Kamalo, the Zoning Board of Appeals, was that a full-time member or an associate member? Associate member, okay. Mr. Kamalo, Mr. Fliegroff from the Cable Advisory Committee, he's been a great participant for years. Do you want to accept that resignation, I guess?
In fact, I would recommend to the board that you make any decision accepting Kurt Fliegroff's resignation.
You want to delay that? We're going to keep trying to talk him into it?
Yes.
Okay. That's what I was wondering. Okay, and then we have two from the Board of Registrars of Voters, Joyce Brousseau and Carol Walsh, also two great volunteers in Hopkinton, but those I think we do need to take action on, correct?
I believe so.
Okay. And then finally, an elected position, Mr. Winchman, Paul Winchman from the Board of Health. So why don't we take these one at a time and we'll come to have a little bit of discussion maybe on some of them. So the chair will entertain a motion to accept the resignation of Nupa Patel from the Zoning Board of Appeals associate position.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Obviously, we would like to send a letter thanking them for their service, thanking Nupa for the service to the community. If we could, please. I'd be happy to sign it. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you, Nupa, and we'll get a letter out formalizing that. We're going to table item number 2. It's on the agenda, so let me come to my colleagues here. It's on the agenda. Mr. Kamalo would like to try and convince Kurt to hang around. You guys okay with tabling that for right now?
I'm very okay with that.
Mrs. Wright, you okay with that?
Yep.
Okay. So we're going to table item number 2, not take any action. Item number 3, Joyce Brousseau and Carol Walsh from the Board of Registrars of Voters.
So moved.
Okay, so Mr. Ted Stone is moving. We accept the resignation of those two. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Mr. Kamalo, same if we could please. Two great volunteers for the community. We'd like to get a nicely worded letter out to them thanking them for their service, and I'd be happy to sign that. Okay, so all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? So that one's unanimous and so carries. The fourth one is Paul Winchman from the Board of Health. This is an elected position. Mr. Kamalo, he was firm in his resignation, correct?
Yes.
Okay. So the chair will entertain a motion to accept the resignation of Paul Winchman from the Board of Health.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? So that's unanimous and so carries. Specific to the Board of Health process, actually specific to the last two items, You know, Zoning Board of Appeals, we have folks come and go fairly regularly. There's a lot of people on the board and associate members, and you know, we can address that in due course. We're going to table two. But for Joyce and Carol and for Paul's position, for Joyce and Carol, similar to what we did before, is that an elected position?
It's appointed.
Those are appointed. Okay. Yeah, we appointed. That was a temporary, but we also appoint for the regular. Got it. Thank you. Our town clerk is here tonight helping us. We'll need to, is there a time crunch on that one for those two positions? Please, if you would. Connor Deegan, our town clerk, is going to help us just sort through this real quick.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Because there's no, the closest election is the primary in September, we actually do not have to worry about it too much, but I would recommend, for the sake of petitions that are still coming in, that we find two members as soon as possible. When doing this, because of the political balance of the board, and currently there is only an unenrolled and a Democrat on the board, both town committees will need to be informed that there's vacancies, and then anyone else can step forward to apply as well.
Okay. So with the Board of Selectmen being the appointing authority, the Board of Selectmen should make the announcement that we see, we're seeking two candidates? Is that
yes.
Fair?
Okay. Yes.
And then we'll let folks know as they apply, we can get into the details of which types of representation we need on the board. Is that fair?
Yes, a lot of that can be discussed in the hearing for who will be the board's appointments. One of the keys will be to send notice to both committee chairs for both the Republican and Democratic town committees so that they can submit their applicants personally as well.
So who should send that notification to the chairs?
That would be from the Board of Selectmen seeking applicants for the Board of Registrars.
Okay, great. So under Mr. Deegan's recommendations, Mr. Kamal, if we could implement what he's just described to help, that would be great.
Do that.
Okay, everybody good? All right, and then finally, for Mr. Winchman on the Board of Health, that is an elected position. That would require that the Board of Selectmen gather with the Board of Health, similar to what we did on night one of your selectman careers.
Yep.
And we'll have a joint hearing, and there'll be five members of the Board of Selectmen. By the way, we're getting into vacation and season here. We've got vacations and work travel with two of our colleagues. But we'll have five members of the Board of Selectmen. We'll have two members of the Board of Health for a total of seven. And we'll appoint jointly a member to serve for a period of time through the next election cycle. Is that correct?
Yes.
So the Board of Selectmen needs to make the announcement to seek candidates. Is that correct?
Yes, the town will post the announcement for a minimum of 10 days. And following that, as the chair explained, there will be a joint hearing of the Board of Selectmen and the remaining members of the Board of Health.
A joint hearing or a joint meeting?
Joint meeting.
Okay. Hearing implies other stuff, right? Mr. Deegan, are you in agreement with what we're describing for the Board of Health position?
I do believe that the Board of Health has to accept the resignation first, but I have not checked the actual bylaw to look at that for them.
Okay.
So you may not be able to accept the resignation until the Board of Health has met to accept it.
So, Mr. Kamalo, we just voted to accept the resignation. We could do that pending.
My understanding is that the director of the Board of Health advised our office that the Board of Health will be meeting on next Monday. And at that meeting, the Board of Health will take up this issue. What is required in the bylaw is that the Board of Health advises the Board of Selectmen of the vacancy created by the resignation. It's not necessarily whether they accept or don't accept. They are simply advising the selectmen that there is a vacancy created by Paul Richmond's resignation.
So our vote to accept the resignation is sort of perfunctory. Really, it's the Board of Health coming back to us and saying, we've got a vacancy, we need some help. So, does that work for you?
Yes.
Okay. Everybody good?
Yep.
Good. So that'll be the process going forward. That will be in our July, I assume that would be at our next meeting in July. Okay. All right. 7:35 p.m. We're right on schedule here. The Board of Selectmen will consider the following appointments to the Upper Trails Committee. Well, hold on one sec. So, we decided for the Upper Trails Committee that we would, given the number of applicants, given the number of public hearings we had this evening, and given how important this committee is to our community, the Trails Committee, and this one in particular, that we'd like to have a full board here for that appointment. And so we're going to suspend or table this one until a future date. Okay?
Okay.
Makes sense. We really try to have full boards whenever possible.
Sure.
And especially when we get into appointing individuals to key committees, the more participation we can have, generally the better it is for everybody. So item number one, we're going to table. Item number two, we have the Irvine Todaro Property Advisory Group that is working to help set forth a plan for that property. And we are the appointing committee for that group. The school committee representative of the school committee has set forth that they are asked that Nancy Kavanaugh serve as the committee, serve on the committee as the school committee representative. Does anybody want to make a motion to appoint Nancy Kavanaugh as the school committee representative to the Irvine Todaro Properties Advisory Group?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries.
Just a
Mrs. Wright.
Point, Mr. Herr. Going back to the Upper Charles Trail Committee, the first nominee, Kelly Karp, is listed as the Parks and Rec designee, so it doesn't sound as if that's a position where there are multiple applicants to be interviewed. The Parks and Rec is simply asked to designate some one of their members, and she is the designee. Would it make sense to move the process along by making that appointment tonight?
That is an excellent question. Thank you. Mr. Kamala.
Yes, I think I'll concur with Ms. Wright that acting on the Park and Rec Commission's designee recommendation to the board tonight will be passes forward. Again, it's a recommendation, and the eventual appointment is by the Board of Selectmen.
And that's a Parks and Rec position, that's their position on the Trails Committee.
The charge affords the Park and Rec Commission the opportunity to name or recommend a designee. The final decision is by the Board of Selectmen.
Okay. It's a great point. Mrs. Wright, would you like to make a motion on item one of item one?
I would move that the Board of Selectmen appoint Kelly Karp as the Parks and Recreation Commission designee to the Upper Charles Trails Committee as recommended by the Parks and Rec Committee.
Would you mind throwing in with the term expiring June 30th, 18?
Position to expire June 30th, 2018.
Thank you.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second on the table for Kelly Karp. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. So Kelly Karp will be the Parks and Rec Commission designee, and then we'll take up the multiple applicants when we have a full board soon. Everybody good? Thank you, Mrs. Wright. Good catch. With that, Mr. Del Torio. Dave, we're running a little early this evening. We'd like to keep your time slot to 15 minutes, but if you're ready to go now,
sure.
That would be great. Let me just do one thing before you go. Yeah, okay. If you could give us your 15-minute presentation on the update of the downtown corridor project, that would be much appreciated. Mr. Kamala.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. To set the context, the reason why here is to update the board on the progress made so far in the town's discussions of the 25% submission to Mass Highway with the Mass DOT staff. Specifically, what you will hear tonight are updates from our engineers regarding incorporating feedback the town has received from different parties in relation to incorporating a bike trail, realigning the Main Street intersection, and also undergrounding utilities. You'll also hear tonight progress made with regard to addressing the parking issue along the corridor. And then finally, Dave will also confirm to the board the status of the funding for this project within the TIP program. And also, we felt tonight would be a great opportunity for us to introduce to the board as well as to the community the consultants who have been working with the town on this project, and I'll let, with the chair's permission, let Dave do the introductions.
Okay, before you jump in, Dave, just real quick. So what we're doing tonight is we're updating the board and the community via our meeting on what's going on with the downtown revitalization project or the road improvement project. This is not a public hearing. This is not the end game. This is not the last time we will weigh in on it. This is not the last time we've seen this. This is an update, okay? So with that context, let's go ahead and get some updates from the town engineer. But we don't want to get into a debate tonight or a back and forth on the specifics. We're just kind of see where we are, okay? We only have 15 minutes. We could talk about this for 3 hours. So let's just keep it at the level it needs to be for tonight. I can assure the board, my colleagues, as well as the community, that we will talk about this a great deal. And there will be numerous public hearings and opportunities for the public to weigh in on what we're looking at and get any input we can built into the plan at the appropriate time. Okay? Everybody good?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, Dave. Go ahead.
Okay. I just wanted to go through the funding through the MPO. We went to a recent MPO meeting in Boston with the chair of the planning board, Ken Weismantle, and we confirmed that the town stays on the 2019 funding. So, I mean, we're still on the tip, as they say, and the project is still funded. So, that's actually a really good thing. They were looking at moving the project from 19 to 20, so that's a good update, good news for the town. Let me introduce the consultants from VHB. They can go through the, some of the key areas to show, the changes in the bike lane, the realignment, where we're going to be undergrounding, and some of the key areas for some of the parking. John Bouchard is the program manager in the Worcester office. Brian Brosnan is the project manager. Brian's the day-to-day contact for the town. So we can turn it over to John to kind of just give a quick update to the board on those few items. Yeah, I'll scroll through.
Okay, thanks. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you for allowing us to be here tonight and introduce our team. We've been working with Dave and John Wessling from Public Works for the last little over a year and a half, or coming up on a year and a half, to take the project through the public hearing stage, to the Mass Highway public hearing stage, through final design and right-of-way, and into construction to kind of align with that 2019 TIP. That 2019 TIP actually begins in October 1st of 2018, so it's just, you know, they work on a federal fiscal cycle, so I just wanted to stay on that. What we've been involved with Dave and my design team in Worcester is the introduction of the two-way separated bike lane between Wood and Grove Street, coordinating with Dave on the underground utility design by Eversource, which is between Summer and Ash, and also the realignment of the Cedar Grove Street and Main Street intersection, changes there, and coordinating all that through MassDOT. The introduction of the two-way separated bike lane really came as a result of the Board of Selectmen in coordination with the Upper Charles Trails Committee, getting their input, saying this is something that you know, the town wanted to pursue. We approached MassDOT at the time and kind of coordinated those two elements, or those multiple elements, and then looked at what was the best way to introduce that to the project, what impacts it would have to right-of-way, to private, you know, to property, also the operations, and what could be done safely. DOT wasn't, I should say, it was something that they were in favor of, but they wanted to make sure we were able to coordinate all those elements. So we've been able to introduce it, as I said, from Wood up to Grove Street. On that would be the southerly side of Main Street for that location. What we're actually preparing, based on those three main items that I wanted to discuss, we'll be preparing an updated or resubmission of the 25% design. The plan that went into DOT originally didn't have some of these elements incorporated. They require that the separated bike lane, the undergrounding in the center intersection, or the Route 85 and Grove and Cedar Street intersection, be shown on the plans, identify the right-of-way required, and have that be resubmitted. Right now, we're waiting on the Eversource design of the underground so we can coordinate the other elements of the utilities and get that package back into them this summer. As you stated, it's not the end game. We have a series of public meetings that need to occur to get DOT. You know, DOT's looking for public input on the project, especially with some of the changes that are being implemented along, you know, along the corridor. So they've encouraged Dave to make sure some of those meetings get scheduled. But one of the first steps is for us to take that Eversource design, which we're supposed to get at the end of this month, and incorporate that and coordinate those utilities for any changes that might be required in right-of-way actions, you know, along the corridor, and get that back into them sometime this summer. And that'll still maintain that 2019 TIP. Dave, why don't you go up to the center, the Grove Street intersection, just so, unless you want to slide right through the... two-lane bike lane will start at Wood on the southerly side of Main Street and run along that entire that section of the corridor all the way up until we hit Grove Street. Both bike directions will be on that southerly side. We have crossings at each of the side streets along the intersection. Then they'll also be crossing driveways that are to private property through the fire station and the police station at this location, and then as we approach the Grove and Cedar Street intersection. Once we get to, stay right here for 1 second, Dave, once we get to the intersection, you can see that the two-way bike lane is ending right at the intersection, if I can get my, right at this location, and then bikes that are heading in the easterly direction would continue on the southerly side of Main Street. Bikes that would be coming westerly along Main Street would come across the intersection and then tie back into that separated bike lane. And then once we get beyond this point, we have the bike lanes that are on each side, or on either side of the street, all the way up through Hayden Row.
They're separated by these buffers that are shown right now in red. It was really, you know, there was options to grass it, to put concrete, to put some other materials. We're showing a different color just to show that there's a distance or a differentiation between the roadway and the bike lane. Those are some of the details that we would look for input from the community as part of some of that public meeting process. We currently are only bringing it up to Hayden Row because of the future, you know, connection up with the center school. Brian Brosnan from my office was with the Upper Charles Trail Committee today doing some walking up that route to see how that piece is going to be connected in there. So right now we're showing it stopped at Hayden Row because it's ultimately going to connect into that that other segment. Yeah. Again, we did meet with Eversource just about 2 weeks ago in the field to do that first look-see of their current design. They're refining it, and they're due to get that back to us by the end of next week, so that way we can kind of troubleshoot it with the other utilities and see what easements might be necessary before it needs to get back into MassDOT. Let's see. Touching on parking, with the introduction of 6 parking spaces at the police station and, you know, within the entire corridor goes from, is it Mayu, all the way up to Ash, there's about 100 parking spaces along the corridor right now. And the design with the 6 spaces introduced at the police station will total about 84. So there has been some loss of overall parking. And we're still working to introduce as much additional parking as we can within the corridor. What's a little difficult is that those 100 spaces, when they were originally looked at, not everything's a legal space. And when we're working with MassDOT and FHWA, everything has to follow the MUTCD, which is the Manual and Uniform Traffic Control. So everything has to be, you know, certain size, so far away from an intersection in a driveway. So when the initial count was done on the project, the 100 spaces were generally, you know, 20 to 25 feet from here to here. And anything that's within 20 feet of an intersection is really not a legal space. You know, people are going to park there, they're going to, you know, use whatever space they're available. But when we look at it and we introduce that with DOT, they're a little more stringent in FHWA on their guidelines. So right now we feel we have 84 legal spaces within those limits, and we're going to continue to work to introduce additional spaces as needed, coordinate that through the town manager's office and through engineering. It's something that we know is sensitive, and we're just doing our best to try and introduce some more and not impact what's there. Last piece is, at the Grove and Cedar Street intersection. We've looked to implement, you know, we've realigned Grove Street to better align with Cedar and improve on the intersection configuration and traffic operations there. It's still a work in progress. You know, we're coordinating with DOT and making sure that we're able to get enough, get the traffic to flow and be more efficient through the intersection, but it's something it'll be a work in progress over the next few months as we go through their reviews. But we have a workable design with getting the split phase operations that are there today, where the left turns are the opposite ends. Cedar and Grove are both running at different times. We're going to be able to run those concurrently because of the realignment of the intersection, so the left turns will be able to run together. Then we'll be able to run the throughs. The way it's happening right now is Cedar Street goes first, then Grove Street, then the main line. And what happens with that is it steals a lot of the green time from the overall signal operations. So by realigning such as this, we're going to be able to run those concurrently, be able to utilize the same amount of green time overall, and be able to share some of that green time by approach. It'll make things a little more efficient. And we're still looking at, you know, pedestrian, how the pedestrian and bike phasing is going to work, whether it's concurrent or exclusive, whether we're going to shut everything down and be exclusive for peds and bikes, or we're going to work those concurrently. So those are things that we'll be working on again over the next few months with DOT and the town. With that, I would entertain any questions or turn it to Dave for anything that did I miss anything that you wanted to talk to?
Those are about the
main points for the update.
Okay, thank you for the update. We have 8 minutes to have a discussion, and then we're going to go to our public hearing right at 8 o'clock. I'll start with my colleagues, and then we'll make our way around a little bit, but we're going to cut this off at 8 o'clock. This is an update. This is not a final plan. This is directional. I think we're making good progress here. I know it doesn't suit everybody's needs at the moment, but we're going to be talking about it quite a bit as we move forward. With that, Mr. Tedstone.
Yeah, on the bike path, the two-lane bike path, it doesn't make sense to me why we would have a bike path going from Wood Street to Grove Street. Just doesn't make sense why we would do that. If there's not a bike path that's going to connect the entire parcel, what are people going to do, ride back and forth from Wood Street to Grove Street?
Well, there's a, in coordination with the Trails Committee, there is currently a trailhead that comes out right across from Hopkinton Lumber. It actually goes over to the Loop Road,
yep,
behind the schools, I think.
Yep.
And I know the Trails Committee is trying to, you know, incorporate that into a larger trail, all the way over to the new school property and EMC Park, and
yep,
you know, if at all, well, anyway, if at all possible, to the Milford Trail. But I'm not sure if that's still something that they're looking to do. But the goal from working and coordinating with the Trails Committee is to incorporate all of that into the downtown project, so that if somebody's coming from, you know, from the bike trail that's here, they'll come down, they can get onto this bike and come down to the downtown area and get to the Common, or and even loop back, like John had said. We're still working with them on the other end. How do we tie this end of the project into the center school property, because they're, yeah, trying to have a trail come out over there. So there is kind of a larger, you know, another group working on kind of a more town-wide trail network. We're doing the best to try to incorporate that trail network into this downtown design.
Mr. Kamal, sorry, one sec. Sir. Did you have a comment specific to the bike trail or a bike path?
I think Dave touched on that the intent here is to at least incorporate the bike trail along Main Street into the overall center trail, which, okay, is longer than what you see here.
So are there any talks or concept moving forward to hot top or pave the bike trail? Because you're talking about two different types of bicycling there, where people on mountain bikes generally don't ride down the road, and a road bike isn't going to ride down the center trail. So it's great to say that we're going to incorporate both, but a guy on a mountain bike who's riding down a gravel trail isn't going to use a bike path to go to Grove Street.
If I could...
let me jump in, if I could, sure, real quick here. Given the time constraints that we have, it's fair to say that Mr. Tedstone's not sold on the bike path.
That's very fair. To say.
Okay. Very fair. So let's take that as a data point.
Okay.
And let's come back to that at a future time. But we're going to need some better answers, obviously, for Mr. Tedstone to continue.
Not that I'm an avid bicyclist.
Well, if I could, I realize you want to kind of stop our talk here. I just want to be able to say, as part of DOT and FHWA funding, we need to incorporate all modes within the corridor. So Typically, we would have 5-foot shoulders on each side of the roadway on Main Street that would facilitate bicycle usage. The town, based on input from the Upper Charles Trails Committee, wanted to go with the separated bike lane. So it changed the dynamic just a little bit to say we prefer to have a two-way lane on one side. So that changed it a bit. But DOT would have was requiring that the town incorporate 5-foot shoulders that would be bike lanes within the entire project limit. So what we did is we just modified that. And I think incorporation with where the bigger picture is for the town is extremely important, and we want to do that. It doesn't make sense to build, you know, a 7,000-foot bike path and you're going to ride back and forth. But I think the bigger picture, what the town's working on, but we tweaked it a little bit by putting them both on one side and having that separation between the traffic and the bike lane itself.
Does anything else jump out at you?
That's it.
All set. Mrs. Wright.
I got too many questions for now, but I'll just focus on two things. I wasn't clear on the construction of the bike path, what that buffer is, how that's separated from the traffic. It looked on the cross section like there's a granite curb, so it's sort of up at sidewalk level. How does that get plowed? How does that enter in when there's snow on it if it's at a different level?
Whatever town responsibility on sidewalks, it's similar to a sidewalk in that it's separated, has a vertical separation between traffic, so a vehicle's not going to, you know, by mistake just go over, get into that and injure a bicyclist. So it would need to be maintained in that regard, because there is going to be a 3-inch to a 6-inch separation vertically, as well as it would be separately paved.
Okay, so that's how you keep a parked car from encroaching.
Yes.
It's raised, so it's treated more like a sidewalk in terms of maintenance and plowing.
Yes, but we still want to separate bikes and pedestrians.
Right,
so
right. And my other question is the bump outs, the pedestrian bump outs that seem to result in narrowing the traveled way. Are those a requirement for this type of funding, or is this just something that we're putting in because you think it's a pedestrian nice?
We feel it's an improvement for pedestrian access across Main Street.
But
it's not being required. It's something
required.
That will help with traffic. It will help with shortening the distance for pedestrians, giving them safer haven for crossing.
But that could be discussed, then. It's not
yes.
a requirement, because I am concerned that it's narrowing the traveled way and it's clogging things. And I've seen this happen where all of a sudden, when one car is reduced by one of those, the rest of the traffic can't get through. And
understood.
I am concerned about the balance between traffic flow and pedestrian niceties.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so we have a nice update. There's been a lot of work done here. There's obviously a lot of work to do. As you can see in our very brief discussion, there's going to be some opportunities for further discussion around town. It's a big project, and you know we want to do it right. But with that, I think we should table it for now and move on to our other agenda items this evening. Mr. Kamala, do you have any closing comments?
Intended for the public again. We are always seeking public input, and if anybody has any suggestions that they feel we need to be aware of, please feel free to reach out to the town manager's office, Dave Del Toro, town engineer's office, or John Westerly, or even Elaine.
Excellent point. Thank you.
I just want to raise one last thing. It appears that there's a whole chunk of the common, the grass apron, that is being taken, and that's a historic district. That is a protected piece of property under a Mass historic district, and so that's something you might want to consider, because if you are taking that chunk off the common in a protected area, that's probably going to cause a problem.
It's an excellent point to raise. We'll look at that a little more closely with Dave.
Okay. With that, thank you all very much for your input and the update. And we look forward to further discussions about our downtown
thank you for your time.
Pavement project. Have a good night. With that, it's 8 o'clock, and it's time to open the public hearing specific to the Hopkinson Tennis and Swib Club, LLC, who is seeking a general on-premises all-alcohol liquor license and action by the Board of Selectmen to approve the license. The public hearing will be such that the Board of Selectmen will consider, so that the Board of Selectmen will consider approving a new liquor license application for a Section 12 general on all premises all liquor like liquor license. What times can you say that in one sentence? So, does anyone want to make a motion to open the public hearing for this liquor license?
So moved.
Second. Second.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay, so the public hearing has been opened on the liquor license request. Typically what we do is we have the proponent come and join us at the microphone and make their presentation as to what they're doing and why the liquor license is part of that plan, and ask, you know, state their request. And then the board will have some dialogue with the proponent, and we'll get with our town staff, and then we'll go out to abutters, we'll go out to the public, we'll close the public hearing, and then we'll deliberate and go from there. So if you've got some pictures and things you want to set up, that's fine if you could do it right here. And then if you could join us at the microphone so that the folks at home can hear as well, that would be great. Does everybody understand the process we're going to go through? Everybody good with the process?
Yes.
Kamal, you good?
Yes.
Okay, so with that, we'll turn it over to those that are seeking the application or seeking the license.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Mark Donahue on behalf of Hockington Tennis and Swim Club. With me this evening to answer your questions with regard to the application is the owner of Hockington Tennis and Swim Club, Donald Satterfield, right here in the orange. And the gentleman setting up a couple of photos for you is Robert Green, who is the consultant to the club. And very experienced in both resort and club tennis programs. A couple of housekeeping matters, Mr. Chairman. I have the return of the abutters notifications that you need to have as part of your file.
Okay, if you could just give those to our friends over here.
And the second thing is that, thanks, appreciate that. By a letter from the building inspector yesterday, he issued an address for the property. Before it was just simply a lot because it's a vacant property right now. We went through and revised the application we have filed with you to create that date for all purposes, so you'll have that in your file, and I also make that part of the file.
Excellent. Thank you.
Copy of the letter.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Great.
As indicated in the public notice, what is sought by Hockington Tennis and Swim Club is a general all-alcoholic beverage license to be used in conjunction with the club to be constructed on Lumber Street. The club is permitted already by a special permit having been issued by the Planning Board in December of 2015 and is in the process of final design to move forward with construction this year. To give you a better understanding of what the club's involved with that we presented to the Planning Board, the building itself that is part of the tennis club, the permanent structure is approximately 39,000 square feet, has two different levels, has the facilities that you can see somewhat on the picture over to my right. That includes part of the area for the alcohol. In addition to the building itself, there are 10 tennis courts, which are all exterior, but will have a bubble structure for the purposes of playing in the colder season. And it has a pool facility, a 25-meter competition pool, and another active pool that can be utilized, that will also be open to the elements during the warm weather and be subject to a bubble during the course of the year. What we seek to do is to serve alcohol on a general basis within the property in two specific locations. The first of which is shown in the green area that you can see on the plan to my right. It is a lounge and kitchen or dining area. It is designed with 78 seats presently. It will have a relatively small menu, so it will be serving some food, but it will not be a restaurant open to the general public. It's primarily an amenity to the members within the club for those purposes. In addition to that area, we seek to be able to serve alcohol within the pool area, limited to the warm weather months when it is an open active pool outdoors. And the area that you can see there, which is kind of located down to the right, as Mr. Green indicated, is the area in which the alcohol would be served while on the pool deck at that time. As I mentioned, this is primarily a member amenity. But the club will also make available alcohol sales to, obviously, guests of members, to visiting clubs who come to the facility to compete with the club in various aspects, and to spectators who may be attending different events either on the swim side or on the tennis side to be able to either observe their children or their loved ones or even higher level competition, which is expected also to exist at the club. We submitted to the board a relatively detailed procedure and protocols for the utilization of the alcohol on site that demonstrates that all the servers will be tips trained. It answered some questions that the police department had posed in advance, and that I think policies and procedures gave the answers that were requested by the police department. We're glad to review those in detail, should you so desire, with any particular questions that you have. We are very excited as a group to be coming to Hopkinton. We believe that the club is going to be a wonderful addition to the community. Look forward to starting construction and having it open in 2017. We seek the application now so that we can do two things. We can obviously design the facility knowing that we have the alcoholic beverages available, but it will come as no surprise to you that pre-sales of memberships is an important component of our business plan, and we need to be able to tell those people what we're going to be able to offer them in the nature of amenities. That's what I have for a presentation, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Both Mr. Satterfield, Mr. Green, and I would be glad to answer any particular questions you, town staff, or the public may have.
Great. Thank you very much. So, typical public hearing format. Mrs. Wright.
The pool, which is an outside serving area, is there going to be any outside egress or that would allow someone to leave the premises carrying alcohol, or is it all controlled, the egress all controlled from the inside?
It's all controlled by the inside. The only way to enter the pool area itself is to go through the club and pass, therefore, through the membership portal to identify yourself as a member appropriately in the appropriate fashion. As far as service is concerned, there will not be any permission to travel within the areas of the club with alcoholic beverages. People can certainly walk around the pool deck with a beverage should they so desire, but they wouldn't, by way of example, be permitted to take an alcoholic beverage into the locker room or to take it somewhere else on the club in some fashion.
So in both the lounge and the pool area, there will be some control over people leaving the facility to make sure that the alcohol stays within.
That's correct.
And does the pool have a lifeguard, or is there any oversight for someone who may have imbibed and then there are water issues?
Sure. Let me answer the question in two fashion. Not only will the servers that are working in the pool area be tips trained, but they'll be particularly trained as far as health and safety issues surrounding the aquatic nature of the pool. There are safety factors around the pool in some fashion. Mr. Green probably can describe in more detail what those are as far as numbers of lifeguards and how they are involved. Bob?
Our staff, well, first of all, thank you very much for the
Would you mind joining us at the microphone so people can hear at home?
Do that.
Thank you. We don't have the hanging mics yet. We're working on it.
Thanks for the opportunity to be here. My name is Robert Green. I'm from Rangeley Lakes, Maine, which is a beautiful place to live if you can find something to do, which explains why I'm working here in Hopkinton.
A snowmobile up in that area.
So, yes. Yeah, so you know where that is. Our business plan calls for an aquatics director and a full aquatic staff of up to 12 people, which will include lifeguards and pool attendants. The food and beverage staff calls for a food and beverage manager who will, obviously through training, interact with our aquatics department to address Ms. Wright's question as far as managing the guests and the consumption levels. And I think one of the things I had planned to do in terms of staff training was to actually do what I call situational training. And this is something I've done in other positions that I've held, where you actually take certain scenarios that might occur and you actually do a run of it to actually have a written protocol in case you need to address something like that.
Okay. Good for now?
Good for now.
We can come back. Mr. Tedstone.
Well, the concept of this is not unique to Hopkinton. I know that we have at the Country Club, of which I'm a member, a similar concept where we have a snack shack and a place that they sell alcohol out there, and it's monitored by 4 to 6 wait staff as well as 3 or 4 lifeguards, and it works very well. It's if you're going to the pool with your family and you're going to have some lunch, then maybe you'll have a beer or a glass of wine or something like that. So, you know, I don't foresee this to be Cheers with a pool attached to it. And I also, through years of buying equipment from Donnie, I know that he is a guy that lives in town. He loves Hopkinton, and I know for a fact that Donnie wouldn't do anything detrimental to put the town at risk or to put himself at risk, because he is an active member of the community. So I don't have much of a concern as far as the pool and the liquor sales go. You know, if it follows, even vaguely follows the footprint that the Country Club works, then, and I'm sure that it will, because it's going to be a private club. I'm sure it's going to be a great asset to our community.
Okay. Anything else?
That's it.
So before we kind of go out to others, if I could just jump in on a couple of things. How many members, what's an optimal number of members for the club?
I think...
without getting into trade secrets here.
We've actually already talked about that and where we would cap it. I think we do really well in the first year or two. We'll have about 1,400 or so members, and perhaps we'd have as many as 1,600 to 1,800 over the next 3-year period.
Okay. And how many parking spaces will this facility have on site?
We have
126. Okay. Does that sound close to Mr. the planning board chair is directly behind you there? Is that in line with what you're thinking?
That's what we approved.
Yeah. So you approved it, but right around that number. So we don't have 1,400 parking spaces. We don't have a wedding of 1,400 people there because 1,400 members are all coming to the same wedding, right? Just trying to get the scope of what could go on. And then in terms of functions, will the club be available for functions for whether it be members or outside individuals to come to the club through a member that sponsors it, et cetera, weddings and things like that?
Well, our integrated business plan calls for members to be able to rent space to have functions, but we don't have the capacity, at least in the winter, we won't, for a wedding. And our initial thoughts are we wouldn't be holding any events of that magnitude, like a 300-person wedding or anything like that. We were thinking more of if club members wanted to have a party, like a birthday party for their children or something like that at the pool, we would be able to accommodate that. With use of the, you know, indoor facilities in the gymnasium. Okay. But I can't, but to be completely transparent, I can't discount that someone might not come to us and say we'd like to have our wedding here. At that time, we would have to ascertain what the impact would be and then make a determination. And I'm fairly confident in saying that our disposition would be that common sense would prevail in that case.
Okay. So I guess we can talk about it a little bit later too, but I just want to take the chance or the opportunity to just kind of put it out there, because everybody we talk to about alcohol licenses, we basically say the same thing. We have a lot of establishments. The town is growing. We have a lot of establishments with liquor licenses in Hopkinton. We have a lot of establishments that have come to us in the last year or two, maybe 3 years at the most, back asking for liquor licenses. So there's a lot of fun going on in Hopkinton, and that's fine. That's good. But with that comes a lot of responsibility. and this board takes its role and its responsibility to protect the community very seriously. If you stick around tonight, you'll see exactly what we're talking about with respect to protecting the community. The police chief is going to address us on some issues that have taken place and some of the things that we're doing, that we're going to do to rectify those situations. We suspend licenses, I hate to say regularly, but we suspend them quickly with little fanfare and little thought. We don't have to renew licenses if people don't behave on an annual basis. And we, not that we have pulled a license from anybody in my 10 years on this board now, with a couple of vacations in between terms, so I've been at it a while. We haven't pulled a license for a year from anybody, or 2 years that I recall, but we've come close. We have definitely suspended licenses, and it hurts people financially. It would mess your business model up for a month or two if you'd lost your license for a while. So everything that your attorney said was spot on and perfect, but the community takes it very seriously, and please understand that we expect you to run this operation, if you get this license, responsibly and respectful of the community and your neighbors around you, and the neighbors in the distance that are driving, people are driving to and from, and understand it will, it's an accountability thing, okay? So I'm sure you will, but we say it to everybody. We have to be fair, we have to be clear. So with that, what I'd like to do next then is go to the staff and see if there's any questions or thoughts about the application and their presentation. Mr. Kamal.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. My understanding is that during winter, there will be a bubble over the pool area.
That's correct.
Help me understand what the arrangement is in the non-winter months. Specifically, my interest is in whether there is a physical barrier that clearly delineates what area the town is going to be licensing for alcohol around the pool.
That's a good question, and we have actually addressed that. It'll be difficult for me because my arm's not long enough and I'm next to the microphone, but the pool will be surrounded in the summer and the winter. It'll be surrounded. It'll be a fenced-in area. It will have a gate, obviously, for purposes of delivery. And also for emergency exit only. So everything will be contained within the pool area. Now, in the wintertime, when the air structure is up, there will be no food and beverage service at the pool at all. So as far as that's concerned, it's even more contained, but a moot point. As far as the, as we have described in our adjunct document to the application, there's a little kind of down at the bottom on the pool to the left there. That's where the food and beverage will be served, or distributed, if you will.
Okay.
And we have a system designed to lock up and cage on wheels, if you will, roll out and store in a locked area in terms of making sure we keep track of that. I spent 19 years as a manager at the Balsams Grand Resort Hotel in New Hampshire. We sold liquor second, we were second only to the state liquor stores in New Hampshire up there. So none of this is lost on me, and I'm proud to say that on my watch nothing ever went wrong. We've got a fair amount of experience in how to do this, and really do appreciate the need for controls. One other point I think is appropriate to make here with regard to Selectman Herr's comment is that I'd like to point out that this is one revenue stream for this club. We have fitness, we have tennis, and we have aquatics. This is more of an amenity than something we really rely on. That stated, I think it's fair to say that we'll be extra careful with it, and we'd be more quickly to close early and say no rather than to say yes, because our income does not solely depend on that. And that's somewhat of a philosophical thing, but a fact nonetheless.
Sure. Mr. Kamal.
Two related questions to my earlier question. Is it correct that the point of sale for the alcohol will only be within the building structure, and that there will not be any point of sale or distribution in the pool area?
There will be point of sale in the pool area. There will be a portable bar in the pool, down in that little food and beverage service area that Mr. Satterfield pointed out in the lower left-hand corner.
Which therefore brings up my third question. Did I understand you correctly that there will be a gate coming into the pool area, which is distinct and different from the entry point from the building structure to the left of the pool?
The only way you'll be able to enter the pool area, if you're a member of the club, will be to walk in the main level, check in, scan your card at the front desk, walk down the stairs, down the corridor, by the locker rooms, and out a door to get into that pool area. We have a fence surrounding it. We have a gate, because we have to have a gate, which is an emergency exit, and something that we can use to bring pool equipment and supplies through when necessary. Now, whether or not that gate will be locked during pool operating hours will be dependent totally on what we are required to do by statutes governing that type of thing. So I'm considering it to be somewhat of an emergency exit, if you will, but it's something that I would prefer to keep secured and have someone right next to it to keep an eye on it in the event that we were required to keep it unsecured. This is one of the reasons why we designed the food and beverage service area to be kind of right next to that gate.
Yeah, I can't see it being...
Hang on one second. Let's just finish up over here first.
Just to close off this discussion, I just want to confirm from both you and the attorney that you are both familiar with the ABCC guidelines for extension of premises to patio and outdoor areas, and that you have incorporated those guidelines into your planning process?
Yes.
Anything else, Mr. Kamal? Mrs. Lazarus? Good? Mrs. Wright?
Well, on the issue of the gate, I could see that emergency access gate being alarmed, but based on events that just occurred in Orlando, the concept of any kind of a public meeting space where there's only one exit functioning makes me uncomfortable.
This gate will probably be approximately the size of your desk, just so you'll get a perspective of it. We certainly can very easily have another gate in another location on the opposite side of the aquatics area if that would satisfy that kind of level of discomfort that you might have.
Well, I mean, I'm concerned that alcohol only be consumed on the premises and people not be able to leave with it. So, you know, you wouldn't want a secondary emergency egress that someone could go out without alerting someone, you know, so perhaps you have an alarm type system where, you know, someone's alerted if someone uses that without authorization. But I just feel that public spaces should probably have a second way for emergency exit when something occurs that is untoward.
And that's a good point. And in our report, in one of the sections in the report, I did allude to that in the fact that we would have an electronic notification system, which we plan to use not only at the pool, but also in the main level food and beverage area too, so that when something gets opened, it is a sensitive area.
Right.
A little red light and a buzzer is going to go off, so someone will be able to respond and address whatever the cause of that might be.
Yeah, and I don't believe that Mr. Cadlick would sign off on a building permit without a secondary means of egress. If you need one at an apartment or a house, or you're definitely going to need one there. So I can't imagine.
You already have two.
Unless you have a different gate than the one you're speaking about here, then I can't fathom the possibility of it being locked.
Well, just to make sure we're clear, we have the main entrance that goes into the pool from the building down a walkway, and then we also have the gate which goes out to the access road too.
Okay.
So we have two ways to get out already. But I think Selectman Wright brings up a good point. that both those areas are a little bit close together. So it's my intention to leave here with a little bit of good advice and to take a look, and something we can do fairly easily, and perhaps drop another alarmed gate, you know, on the other side of the pool. I think that makes sense.
Great.
Okay.
Appreciate your transparency.
Any other thoughts, questions at this time? Okay, so we're in a public hearing process. I'd like to open it up to abutters, unless someone has some compelling point they want to make that's participated so far. So are there any abutters here that received an abutter notification, that would like to address the board and the applicant? If you were not an abutter that didn't receive a notification, you'll have an opportunity to speak in a second. We'll just go to abutters first. Any official abutters here that want to speak? Yes. Mr. Kistner, please.
Hi, my name is Clifford Kistner, 86 West Main Street, Hopkinton, Mass. I come before the board in opposition of this liquor license. And the reason why I do is because I'm going to try to best my previous speaker before me. I've been in the business 28 years as a bartender, bar manager, and facilitator of alcohol. I worked at Chew's Waterfront Cafe for 9 years in Providence, Rhode Island, and we had several different stores in New York and one in Florida, and we had pools. And one of the main reasons why Shooters failed was because of pools. They got to a point where people were being served seated in the pool from bars that were in the pool, and people were slipping, falling, concussions, broken bones, and deaths. Now, that being said, I'm not saying that that is a situation here. The thing that I am implying is that the amount of interaction between the concept of a gym slash health facility and a correlation between luncheons with alcohol and children running around and all of the abutters that are neighbors that are in a residential area, this throws to me, 28 years in the business, a red flag. And it harkens to the fact that people will say they'll do their due diligence to police it, but in the end, are there staffers that are ready for drunks that get involved in arguments while after working out and testosterone is high? I've been in the gym my whole life. I'm nearly 60 years old. So I know both of these concepts extremely well. I have not come out of the gym being at my age now. And I've broken my neck and I've broken my back, and I'm not going to go into the long of that, but I've made some small notes here as people were talking. And
Mr. Kistner, if I could just interrupt for 1 minute, it is 8:30. I got to open up another public hearing, and we'll come back to you in just a minute here, so just hold on for 1 sec. So at 8:30, folks, tonight we have another public hearing that we scheduled. While not officially required to hold a public hearing, we decided to do so to give the public a real opportunity to speak to the solid waste and recycling contract that's currently under review. So with that, what I would suggest we do is open that public hearing, and then we'll continue it until such time as we wrap up this discussion. So bear with us for 1 sec. So the chair will entertain a motion to open the public hearing to update the community and hold that public hearing to discuss the solid waste and recycling contract renewal before us.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Mr. Kamal, are you good with opening up that public hearing the manner I just did?
Yes.
All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Okay, so the public hearing for solid waste and recycling is now open. We will continue it until such time as we finish this topic in front of us. Mr. Kistner, sorry.
Thank you. All right, so I had made some notes as we were going, and a couple of them are going to be redundant because I've already mentioned them. But Mr. Ted Stone mentioned a vision of Cheers in with a pool attached. Unfortunately, no matter how much we try, it will be a Cheers with a pool attached, because that's what happens with pools, and that's what happens with alcohol. And when we're talking about special permits, well, that's one thing. But to have a liquor license just handed out to a place that is so close to residentially packed area, to this type of interaction between physicality, testosterone, and children all being involved in the same area, this can be a signature of high detriment as far as I'm concerned. And with no malice intended for your wording on that. Secondly, is you say that there'll be a staff of 12 that would be on hand. Now, would that be 12 staff members per week, split up over a time frame, or is that 12 members constant in the pool areas and in so forth? And I'll just leave that out there to hang for a minute. And then when we get into drinking, and you being in the business for 19 years, as you say, when things erupt, there's what we can call security, or we can call staffing, or we can call bouncers, or we can call it anything we want. But when a situation arrives and something needs to be done, the innocent people that are outside the scope of the argument or the confrontation that goes on are exposed to this type of situation that someone else can get hurt. And I've seen people, and I'm not going to embellish this too strongly except for the fact that it'll be strong in its own right. I've seen people killed in fights over alcohol. And I've watched it from my own eyes. And I say 28 years, in 28 years I've seen a lot. And that being said, I don't believe that to have a facility that is about health and fitness and grouping of families, to expose children to alcohol drinking that are 6 years old, 7 years old, to see their parents drinking while they're enjoying a pool, that's ridiculous to me.
Okay, Mr. Kistner, in the spirit of cooperation with the clock and everything else we have this evening, is there any other points in addition to what you've made that you want to clarify? That
yes, are two
new
more, please.
Pieces of information.
Two more,
please,
yes.
Very quickly.
Okay, traffic. When we talk about 1,300 to 1,500, I'm guessing, members, and 126 parking spots. That's going to be a constant ebb and flow, isn't it? I mean, I would imagine. We're already in a situation over with the Hopkinton Muse going in and everything else. I'm concerned a little bit more about people going there just to drink, and what would that do looking forward? Remember, we've been behind, the horse has been behind the cart in Hopkinton for a while now. This is one of the reasons why I became part of the politics in town. I want to make sure that the safety and the freedom that our townspeople enjoy stays safe, and we have that freedom. And there's a lot going on with alcohol, and we can look at the paper every single day and see it. I'm just concerned. And maybe I'm the only one that is looking at it this way, but I've got 20 years, 28 years vested into it, that I think that it needs to be looked at a little bit deeper, actually a lot deeper.
Okay. Anything else?
All
right, let me move to others that might want to say something. We've got to keep this moving if at all possible. And I don't want to get into a back and forth here just yet, so just we'll come back to that in a minute. Are there any other official abutters that would like to address the issue in front of us? Okay, seeing no others, are there any residents of Hopkinton that would like to address the board specific to this issue? Name and address.
Ed Harrow, Spring Lane. I'm just curious, is there a history of awarding licenses to establishments that physically don't exist? I understand why they want to do it, but I'm curious if licenses are handed out to places that don't exist yet. And the second question is, Mr. Tedstone brought up the facility at the country club, and I'm curious about the hours of operation and if you're serving alcohol there before noontime, which I found a little bit of an issue with.
Okay, let me try and address those. Mr. Kamal, correct me if I'm wrong, which I have been in the past, for sure. Yes, we do. We have issued licenses in advance of buildings being in place as people were building their business model and coming to the board. I can think of a couple of restaurants that were developed in town where we did that. So, yeah, that's, I think, somewhat common. Not common, but it happens. Specific to the hours of operation, the board, this board, with previous members perhaps, spent a couple nights deliberating what the alcohol policy for license renewals would be in the town, and I believe we settled on 11 a.m. to 1 a.m., if my memory serves me correctly, and that was across the community in all locations, and the market was going to sort of decide when people would open and close inside or in that timeline, whatever those hours are. The extreme doesn't happen in either case very often in Hopkinton just because of the way the community is set up. But those hours are fairly consistent. They are consistent for all establishments across town, as they would be for this applicant as well. Is that correct?
Yes, except that the hours that Mr. Hill referred to will take effect January 1, 2017.
Thank you. Good clarification. So we've been working on it. It hasn't been put in place, but that's quote, the deal going forward.
Include Sunday?
Sunday's on there as well, yeah. That's all in that policy.
All the same.
Yeah. Okay, any other abutters like to address, or any other residents of Hopkinton like to address the issue?
Hours of operation.
The hours of operation, good question. I don't know if we heard that or not.
They have listed in the adjunct document the hours of operation. Listen carefully.
Yeah, I thought he was going to do it. Okay, please.
There are two items here. One is the hours of operation. The swimming pool and the club will open probably around 6 o'clock or 6:30 in the morning. There'll be no alcohol served until 10:30 or 11 o'clock in the morning. The pool is slated to close at the latest at 9:30 at night, and the bar and grill, sports bar, if you will, at, I want to say, 11 o'clock or 11:30, if my memory serves me well on the document there.
Okay. Any other questions from the abutters or anyone else want to speak to it from Hopkinton, from the residential pool, if you will? Pardon the pun.
Can I get a definition?
Let me just see if anybody else would like to speak to the issues before us. Anybody else? Mr. Kistner, very quickly, please.
Can I get a definition of this grill / club?
Okay. Sir.
We're talking about a 78 to 80 seat little corner of the club. There will be windows in the club and chairs there overlooking the tennis court so people can go and watch their kids play or tournaments or what have you. It's not, again, it's not going to be open to the public, such as the Shooters was. I would assume Shooters was open to the public. And to that, with due respect, I would suggest that we have a little bit of an apple and an orange here in terms of a private membership club. And we're really talking about, to try to clarify this as best I can, we're talking about three identities that go through during the day for food and beverage service here. In the morning, we're talking about smoothies and nut muffins, healthy snacks and croissants and things like that. Noontime, soups, salads, sandwiches, that type of thing, and light fare for a small sports bar atmosphere in the evening, and again, as an amenity for the members of the club.
Okay, thank you.
Is this already been approved?
Sir?
The club has already been approved?
Yes, the club has been approved by the planning board. So the club has been approved, the uses have been approved, everything that you see on these plans is underway in terms of the process in Hopkinton to date. We're focused specifically on the alcohol license inside the club that's been approved. Okay, any other residents want to address the issue? Is the board comfortable considering closing the public hearing at this point?
Yes.
I do want to make one comment on the hours, that if this board has standardized hours of operation as 11 to 1, the application states 10 a.m. Okay. So this will need to be discussed with the applicant that they're willing to move that to 11.
Do that very quickly once we get the hearing closed.
Okay.
Okay. So with that, the chair will entertain a motion. I'm sorry, go ahead.
It may be helpful receiving this information. It could be new information from the applicant once the hearing is open.
Mr. Kamala always keeps me on the straight and narrow. Please, what are the hours of operation for the alcohol license that you're requesting?
We described the hours of operation in the application based upon the standards as we understood them to exist today as 10 a.m. to midnight as the window for operation. If the policy in the town is to not permit service until 11 o'clock, we'll certainly abide by that and revise our application accordingly.
Okay.
If the policy of the town is to go until 1 a.m., we will not be serving till 1 a.m. We will be stopping earlier, as Mr. Green indicated, either at the poolside or much earlier, and at the other facility somewhere between 11 and 12 for sure.
Okay. Yes, yeah, so just we'll make you aware of what that new policy that will be going into effect, what those hours are, just find out and confirm it, and then if you could modify, that would be
great.
Not
a problem at all.
Okay. So with that, and with Mr. Kamal's and Mrs. Lazarus' approval, I would suggest that the board vote to close the public hearing.
Just one second, Mr. Chair. Just want to clarify this.
While we're waiting, Mr. Kistner, do you have anything else you want to say? You can do whatever you want, but I was just... Yes, sir.
Mr. Chair, I was checking with Elaine Lazarus on an answer to a question that was raised earlier. As part of the ABCC's requirements for issuing a license, there has to be a valid certificate of inspection issued by the building inspector. Do you respond to that issue?
That's true, to actually physically issue the license.
Yes.
But we have no expectation that the license will be officially issued until the structure is constructed. We don't have a facility to serve alcoholic beverages, nor will we. By seeking the approval now, it essentially gives us the assurances that we will be a license holder when we do complete all of that physical inspection. Your physical inspection, I assume your community is like many others, that you would not issue, even internally, an alcoholic beverage license from the Board of Selectmen without a sign-off from the building inspector. So we know all of that, that's going to fall in place when it comes, but as I think previously indicated, it's a fairly regular practice to know that you're going to be issued a license, which are limited in scope and time and availability in a community, in order to make the investment to move forward in that fashion.
So with that in mind, it could be, if the board is inclined to approve the license, that it be subject to the issuance of a certificate of inspection by the building inspector.
Okay. So my two motion friends here have to keep that in mind. One of them, anyway, maybe.
And to be clear, sorry, Mr. Chair, subject to the issuance of a certificate of inspection issued by the building inspector and the fire chief.
Okay. That addresses, I think, what you're talking about. Okay. So with that, I would like to try and get the public hearing portion of this closed.
But actually, now that I see the planning board chair sitting there, listening attentively, when this, if I could ask a question of the planning board chair in his official capacity, when this application came before the planning board, were the uses described this evening also described to you at that time?
I don't remember the function aspects of it, but certainly there was a lounge area of it, and for members' purposes.
Okay.
The planning board does not, I'll say, regulate interior partitions and things like that so much. We're more concentrating on exterior and parking lot. The parking number of spaces was approved or determined by the Director of Municipal Inspections based on locker space, as and they met the requirements based on the number of lockers that would be required.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. With that, and with one last glance at Mr. Camallo, the chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing for the all-alcohol license for the Hopkinton Tennis and Swim Club.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, it's unanimous and so carries. The public hearing is now closed, and the board will take a couple of minutes to deliberate, keeping in mind that we've got other things on our agenda this evening where others are waiting to also address the board on. Mrs. Wright.
I guess I don't have any further questions. I mean, I hear Mr. Kistner's concern. I share some of that myself. That's why most of my questions centered around the pool. But I am not sure whether this board has the ability to pick and choose how the use, what is and is not allowed in an application. I would have to assume and hope that if some of these prognostications came true, that the establishment would perhaps decide that this was not a wise endeavor. Certainly, I've seen this board take disciplinary action when problems occurred in to a license holder. So, that's all I can say.
Okay, Mr. Tedstone.
Well, I'm assuming the atmosphere of the club, with it being a private club, will be similar to the two that pop into my mind are the country club that I belong to, as well as the Westboro Tennis and Swim Club, although I don't know if Westboro Tennis and Swim Club is private. And in the 10 years that I've been a member at the club, I have not ever run into a problem at the pool, which my wife and children use almost weekly, and my children use almost daily. I've not seen an alcohol-related, I'm not saying it hasn't existed, but I've not seen an alcohol-related event happen. And because the risk that you run with an alcohol or with any type of altercation like that is you risk expulsion, which at that point you risk losing a significant amount of money that you've put into that. So it doesn't happen, but I'm not too concerned about the, and again, no offense to Mr. Kistner, he's been in this business for a long, long time. I'm not concerned as much as he is as far as the alcohol-related episodes that may or may not happen. That's all I have.
Okay. Mr. Camallo, and I think I know the answers to these questions, but I want to ask him for just the edification of all. We're not obligated year after year to renew a license, a liquor license, are we?
The town has the obligation to review license applications at the time of renewal. I can share with you that in my prior discussions with Town Council, the option of not renewing the license is a difficult proposal. So in answer to your question, the town has the opportunity to renew licenses at the time of renewal. However, if a decision is to be made not to renew the license, there has to be very strong grounding for or basis for that reason.
So if we have 30 incidents in the last 6 months prior to a license renewal application, we've got some strong evidence that they're not capable of managing a license that they've been issued.
Including the fact that if there are 30 incidents, then
this is a hypothetical I'm describing.
Exactly, the establishment making it to that period. The answer is yes.
Yeah. In addition to that, we do have the authority at any time to suspend the license with satisfactory or sufficient evidence to do so. So I think some of the concerns that are raised, they're very valid, and it's exactly the kind of concerns that we worry about in this community every day. We've already talked about what we're going to do. So I don't think that that would preclude me personally anyway from advancing this question forward or the request forward, but with that understanding, that's how we manage the process. Okay, so anything else anybody wants to weigh in on? Does anybody want to make a motion specific to the request for this all-alcohol license for the Hopkinton Tennis and Swim Club?
I would like to make a motion to approve the license as presented to us on the agenda tonight.
With the would you consider the stipulations that Mr. Kamalo has
absolutely yes with the stipulations
forth.
That Mr. Kamalo has put forth.
Can you repeat those, Mr. Kamalo, for the motion Mr. Ted Stone is crafting?
Yes. One second. Thank you, Mr. Chair. This will be subject to a valid certificate of inspection issued by the Inspector of Buildings and the Fire Chief. In addition, I would like to recommend to the board that there be conditions that specifically address the pool area, and such conditions could include the following. And I'm suggesting these conditions because my understanding is that the pool area is one level below the building area where there will be the main alcohol serving location. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So with that in mind, I would like to recommend to the board that you consider the following conditions with regard to the pool area. That on-duty employee is designated as the person responsible for the control of the area. It can't be, or we understand that there will be servers or waiters in the area, and therefore they will police that area. I would rather the board require that there be an individual specifically designated to control that area.
Mr. Ted Stone, is that in your motion?
It is.
Okay, so the things that Mr. Kamal has stipulated. Anything else, Mr. Kamal?
And that there be, and again, I'm suggesting this now because of the grade, the difference in grade for the pool from the rest of the area, and the fact that there may be multiple gates around the fence that is proposed for the pool area, that the licensee shall post in the licensed outside area, namely the pool area, that alcohol beverages are not permitted outside the licensed outside area. I think having that signage would help address some of the concerns that the board enumerated.
Mr. Ted Stone, is that in your motion?
It certainly is.
Anything else, Mr. Kamal?
That's it for me.
This is how you build a good motion. You delegate, right?
That's it.
Okay. We have a motion on the table.
Just ask, do we usually include requirement of tip certification, or is that understood?
In our adjunct document, that all staff, not only just food and beverage staff, but all managers will also be required to be certified in tips.
I will second Mr. Ted Stone's motion.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any discussion on the motion? Quick question, is the motion, well, I think it's good, it's your motion basically with his name on
my
it.
My motion.
So you're good with the motion, correct?
Yes.
Is the applicant good with the motion before us?
The conditions of the motion are acceptable to the applicant.
Thank you. Any further discussion?
May I just ask, do we need to specify hours of operation, or is it understood that they will conform to the town standard hours?
They will have to conform to the style for the liquor license.
Don't need to specify.
Again, that's in our adjunct document under one of the sections in there where we have stated that we will conform to whatever regulations, policies, and laws the town imposes.
Okay.
Okay.
All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Okay, it's unanimous and so carries.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
Thank you. Have a good night. We'll see you soon. Okay, and with that, we're going to return now to our public hearing that we opened a little while ago, specific to the solid waste and recycling contract renewal. This is the opportunity for the public to come and address the board and speak specifically to the proposed contract that we're considering with E.L. Harvey & Sons. The Board of Selectmen will not be voting on this issue tonight. The Board of Selectmen is going to take as much public input as we can gather in a reasonable time frame. After Mr. Westerling and Mr. Kamala make a brief presentation, highlighted brief, and then we'll close the public. We're going to close the public hearing after that, and then the board will deliberate with all members present in July and make our decision at that time. We're in the process of making sure that no service interruptions will take place between now and the time we make our final decision with E.L. Harvey & Sons. And both of our colleagues that are missing this evening will be watching the public hearing to make sure they get the input that you folks are going to offer us tonight. So all five members, before we vote, will have heard this input. They don't need to be present tonight to vote on the issue at a future date. Does everybody understand the process that we're going to follow this evening?
Yes.
Does everybody, you agree with what I've just outlined there? And I'll go to the public because I want to make sure everyone has an opportunity to weigh in. Is everybody comfortable with the process that I've described? Process only. I don't want to talk about cans yet. Process only. Everybody good? I see lots of nodding heads. Okay, so with that, we'll proceed. Mr. Westerling and Mr. Kamala are going to give us a brief overview of where we are in our discussions and what their suggested recommend or what their recommendation is to the Board of Selectmen specific to the new renewal of the contract. Mr. Westerling, Mr. Kamala.
A couple of points that I want to highlight for the board. We did include some of the comments that we received from the public via email in our office in the board meeting packet. In addition, tonight we also provided a handout of the additional comments that we have received in the office. This is about 15, 20 pages of comments. And in relation to that point, I also want to take the opportunity to thank the public for the input received to date. We have had the comments, and I believe as we have reported back regularly to the board, I have made every attempt to incorporate or address the input we received. Specifically, I think what we learned from the public was the need for us to be flexible. Flexible in terms of the scope, the nature of the program. Flexible also in terms of the sizes of the cuts that will be made available to the public. We also heard loud and clear in terms of continuing to look for opportunities to minimize the financial impact of this program on the taxpayers. And to that end, we did submit two grant applications last week, thanks to the efforts of town staff, John Westerling, as well as our regional coordinator. We were very optimistic in terms of the town's chances in getting those grants. Again, my point here being, we've had very helpful suggestions from the public. We have made every effort to incorporate and address the public's input, and we believe at this point the program has evolved into a proposal that will be beneficial to all parties. And John Westerling is here to highlight the elements of the program.
In the interest of brevity, Mr. Chairman, I don't have anything to add to that.
Love it. Can you just do me a favor and do the citizens a favor and one more time describe what you propose that the community adopt today or going forward? In other words, just say, this is the deal that we'd like you selectmen members to approve so that everybody hears where we're at.
Okay? Absolutely, Mr. Chairman.
I think there's been some good print about that, but let's just verbalize it real quick.
Absolutely, Mr. Chairman. We received three options from E.L. Harvey, and the option that we're recommending is the automated collection of both municipal solid waste, trash, and recyclables. And to that end, what E.L. Harvey will do is they will provide two wheeled carts free of charge to every residence in town that is currently part of the trash collection program, and that's single-family, two-family, and three-family homes. Every residence will receive up to a 64-gallon container for their trash, and every residence will receive up to a 96-gallon container for their recyclables. They will be used by the residents to collect their trash and recyclables. They will be put out on the curb. Trash will be put out every week as it is now. It'll be collected with an automated arm by the hauler. And then the recyclables will be put out every 2 weeks as they are now. I understand that collection is paper every other week and containers every other week. So the recyclables will be collected every 2 weeks. And the other primary difference with the recyclables is that they will all be single stream. So no longer will residents have to sort paper and containers. We'll all go into that one container.
If I could ask a couple quick questions to clarify. So today we're allowed two trash cans. And those two trash cans, if we were following the letter of the contract, which I know there's a little flexibility out there, would be what size?
The maximum per residence is 78 gallons or two barrels. And if you go to Home Depot or Lowe's or any other store, you can't buy 39-gallon containers. All you buy are 32-gallon containers. I can certainly do a display, but typically what people do is they pile the trash on the top of those two 32-gallon containers called snow coning. So they're putting out effectively 78 gallons. With the 64-gallon cart with snow coning on that, you can put the same volume out in that wheeled cart.
Okay. So we're going from two to one, but the one is bigger than the two prior.
The one is 64 gallons, but it will hold the 78 gallons.
Gotcha. Okay. My other question escapes me at the moment. I'll come back to it. Okay. Anything else you want to say specific to what program we're considering? Now, let's say we roll, and we're going to roll this out townwide. We have 4,000 plus or minus residents in town. Maybe it's 5,000. I don't know what the number is. It doesn't matter. We're going to roll it out to everybody. And for those that this program does not work for whatever reason, what are their options?
Their option is to call E.L. Harvey within 30 days of receiving their wheeled carts. Let E.L. Harvey know that they're not interested in participating in the program. E.L. Harvey will come out and retrieve those two wheeled carts.
And then what do they do with their trash and recycling?
For those folks that don't want to use the wheeled carts, they can continue to use whatever methods they use today, whether that's two 32-gallon containers, whether that's putting the trash out in bags, or whatever system they use.
Okay, so in other words, we're going to roll this out to the community as described, single-stream recycling, one big container for all your recycling, put your paper, your cans, everything in one container, and one big container, a 168-gallon container for your trash. They have wheels, you roll it out to the curb. If you can't do that for whatever reason, and there's some folks in town that have presented some very valid reasons why they can't do that, and that's not going to work for them, you can basically continue with what you have today. Is that a fair statement?
Absolutely correct.
Okay. So with that, I'd like to now, unless some of my colleagues want to jump in on something, go to the public and get as much input as we can.
I just want to get clarification from Mr. Westerling. I know they're very flexible on the size as far as the trash containers. You can get 232 instead of 164 if you want that. Is there any flexibility on the 96-gallon recycling that smaller or a couple of smaller containers can be had for that? Because a lot of people are concerned that that's a huge thing.
That is absolutely a possibility, and the hauler is agreed to be flexible and to accommodate people as best that they can. I will say that even the 96-gallon, when it's filled with recyclables, it's very well balanced. It has a cover. It's very easy to tip it back and to pull it out to the curb.
I think some of the concern is storage.
But sure.
They are flexible on size on recyclable
yes.
containers.
Okay.
Doesn't the concept of the 64-gallon, I know that with the big push on the recycling, the 64-gallon, where we're promoting the snow coning, doesn't that promote like an excessive amount of litter? Because if you put your 64 gallons and then snow cone the thing up to, I'm not talking about an Oscar the Grouch snow cone, I'm talking about something like that full of whatever it is, let's say it's packing peanuts.
But doesn't the trash that has to be in bags?
That's correct.
Part of the that's been a part of the program all along.
Absolutely correct. All the trash.
You can't snow cone random trash. You can snow cone bags sitting on top of the trash can, but you can't put random trash out open.
Is that monitored? As we speak now, because I do. I don't put if I have pizza boxes, I don't put a pizza box. You can't recycle a pizza box, and you can't put a pizza box in a trash bag.
I recycle pizza boxes.
You shouldn't.
You can recycle a pizza box.
Let's avoid our inner problem, our own issues here.
As long as the liner is taken out, which has the grease and the food on it, you can recycle the pure cardboard.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Sometimes that's difficult to do. But the 64-gallon container, the bag, the trash is supposed to be in trash bags. No, we don't monitor that. The waste hauler can certainly do that and refuse loads, but I don't think that we want to be policing the loads and leaving trash at the street corner. And that is one of the benefits of the trash cart recycling and trash pickup, is that the containers are large, they have lids on them. Today, if you drive past a lot of people's homes, if they're recycling, they'll put it out in paper bags, they'll put it out in old clothes hampers. That is subject to animals getting in it, to windblown litter. With these, it's all well contained, unless you snow cone it. But if you're snow coning, it's supposed to be in a bag.
Mr. Kamala, real quick.
Real quick, and in fact, to your point, we were really emphasizing public education versus enforcement. And in fact, one of the two grants we have applied for will focus on public education. But as I've also reported previously to the board, we're asking EL Harvey to do more in terms of public education.
Anything else? Okay, so with that, I'd like to open it up to the public. I would ask that the comments be focused on the program that is in front of us this evening, that we sort of whittled this down to, which is that single stream recycling, one big barrel, and then some flexibility if it doesn't work for individual homeowners. So with that sort of backdrop, whoever would like to come first, please join us at the microphone.
Good evening. Tom Smith from 22 Walcott Street. The first thing I want to say is the last time we had a recycling issue and a barrel issue, the taxpayer in town lost because we had unlimited barrels. Most people didn't put out more than two, but it gave us the ability to throw away more trash if we had more trash. And that was a savings of $3 per household in town. So it wasn't a big savings. So the people in town lost that. Now, I noticed he didn't mention, are they going to pick up large items too, like they presently do?
Yes.
Okay, that's good. But that barrel right there, which is the large one for the trash, isn't big enough for most houses. If you have a family of five or six living in a house, you're going to produce twice that every week. Right now, I fill 233 gallons and I snow cone it at the top, and that's pretty difficult. The third thing is, I can handle the barrels, but there's a lot of elderly people in town that can't handle the barrels, and I'm concerned about that. I personally, right now, would like to see the contract stay the way it is. If there's something, those barrels are beautiful. I'd love to see that because my recycles could go in that, and it wouldn't be all over the street like it does now. But I think the contract should stay the way it is until we can research it a little more. And I'm concerned about losing. I want to know what I'm going to lose by allowing the contract to change.
So let me address your question. You're not going to lose anything personally because you can opt out and say, Mr. Harvey, take these back. I'm going to continue with what I'm doing today. Have a nice day.
That kind of defeats the purpose of going to an automated system because...
Well, we have to be flexible. I mean, my home and the way my... I have five kids, and we recycle a ton of stuff. So that's great, and I will fill that. I will never fill that. But everybody's different. So we can't roll it out individually. We got to roll it out as a community, and then we're going to one-off everybody that wants out. So you can opt out.
Yeah, I understand that you can opt out. But is there a point in the future where those people that opt out are now going to be charged additional money by doing this, by saying, yes, I can
contract does not stipulate that at all, no.
Okay. All right.
Thank you for your feedback. Mr. Kistner.
86 West Main Street, Clifford Kistner. To the gentleman's point, we've seen contracts come and be written and then midstream change. And ultimately, the gentleman's question is how long will that be? And I don't hear any deadline on the charging or whatever, or the conformity of people that can't move these barrels, that eventually we're, what do they call it, housewives of Hopkinton or something, where, and I excuse me for using the term, you know, like, are we all cookie cutter? Like, once Harvey makes this transition, they now have the upper hand to stipulate the parameters that go along with it. So if, say, the majority of people start using them, and then without, you know, the people that can't use them now, in time, that contract changes or is restated. As we all know, it happens. And these are going to be out in front of everybody's house, looking the same across the board. And maybe this needs to be more discussed through the town and get more people involved in it to make that decision instead of this small group that sits here today.
So let me answer your question. This is the third time now that we've talked about it since really I think we reconstituted the board. And there's been public opportunities to comment before. That is why we have the program we're discussing in front of us tonight, because we've gotten a lot of feedback about it.
I've seen it.
And that feedback says, if I want to opt out, can I opt out? And the answer is yes. And that feedback says, when will this contract, well, it's not the feedback, but just to answer your question, when will this contract expire? It's a five-year contract. The contract will stipulate we're going to spread them out to everybody, and those that want out can get out, and they can use the exact same stuff they're using today for the balance of the 5 years. It's not going to change midstream, because then that's bad management on our part and on the behalf of the town manager and director of public works.
I understand.
So if we're doing our job, we're going to put a contract in place that's going to be an accountable contract to the supplier, and the people of Hopkinton will know exactly what the deal is. So I'm not worried. I understand what you're saying, but I'm not worried that that's going to take place, because then I'm going to call up Harvey and say, what are you doing? You're violating the contract. And then we'll go get somebody else to do it. I mean, I don't want to go that far down the path, but we're not going to need to.
Okay.
So I'm not worried about changing the contract midstream. 5 years from now, when we have a different board sitting here and perhaps other people in the room, and we're going to be talking about it then, well, those issues will have to be addressed at that time.
Okay.
But for the next 5 years, this is the deal if we vote it. Okay?
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Behind you.
Yeah, my name's Ken Dietz. I'm 44 Alexander Road, and this is the first I heard that you would actually support both the existing method and the new streaming method. This is intended to be the can for trash, the smaller
one? This one here, correct.
That's too small, and I can't really snow kiln because we have a lot of wild creatures around that like to dine on whatever's on top. So the only garbage you could really tentatively snow cone is stuff that's non-food, you know, strictly paper, not paper, but, you know, different kinds of objects that you would throw out that, like, from a garage or something that you wouldn't normally want to, you would normally include in that and not include in recycling. So is there an opportunity to get that size for garbage and that size for recycling?
I don't know the answer to that question. I'm going to ask Mr. Westerling to answer it for you, and then I'll come back to you in one sec.
Mr. Chairman, this is in line with the town's current standard, the town's current regulation, which is 78 gallons maximum. This will accommodate 78 gallons with a snow coning. One of the things that I think that people will find is that when you have a larger recycling capacity, it's easier to recycle, it's easier to fill it, so you'll find that the waste will be diverted from the trash into the recycling bins. And as a matter of fact, the DEP, we received a technical assistance grant a couple of years ago, and what they showed is that communities that go to the 64-gallon trash, they see that they have a reduction of about 13%. So those communities that are using a 64-gallon trash cart are generating about 13% less trash than what Hopkinton's generating.
Mr. Westerling, Mr. Dietz raises an interesting question. If we have a resident who likes that but doesn't like that, can they go with that for recycling but still opt out of that and use their current trash cans, that the two trash cans they have today?
Yes.
And that will be stipulated in the contract?
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, the way that the contractor saves on the fees is that the trucks can go through and they can collect these faster. The driver doesn't have to get out and lift the heavy 32-gallon barrels or whatever else the trash is in. So they will see a reduction in those claims, those back and those slip claims. But the drivers will be the same trucks that are going around now. They'll just be retrofitted with an arm to collect these, so the driver can get out and collect, whether it's recyclables or trash, from those homes that decide to opt out.
Okay. Mr. Dietz, does that answer your question?
Yes and no. It doesn't satisfy me, but it does answer the question. I would prefer if we're allowed 78 gallons, I'd like to see the container hold it, simply because I don't want, you know, consumable trash on top for whatever creature decides to dine on my garbage.
So how are you doing it today?
I put it in trash cans and I lock them down. I lock the lids down because they're going to whip them open.
Okay, so you can continue doing that, okay, but we don't have a can big enough that you're talking about to accommodate your personal needs. You're going to have to opt out of the trash piece and go with the recycling piece.
Why can't I use two of those?
Mr. Westerling.
Because those are 96 gallon, and that exceeds what residents are allowed to put out of the curb.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
This is right.
But to Mr. Dietz's point, my understanding, if he's exceeding the current amount, he must be having to use overflow bags or something if he's right now going over, he's exceeding the current amount, correct?
What I can put in my
okay.
All right. And that edible stuff is always in a sealed container with the lid locked down.
No, but my understanding is if someone is exceeding the accepted amount that the town allows, we're still allowed to use those green purchased overflow bags.
You're absolutely correct. So that somebody mentioned earlier bulk items, the bulk item pickup will not change. You will still call E.L. Harvey and schedule to have that picked up free of charge, one bulk item per household, and the overflow bags will still be able to be used for those folks that are generating more than 78 gallons per week.
Thank you. Who else would like to address this question? B, you'll be next. I'll keep everybody else out of the way. Thank you, Mr. Weissmantle.
Thank you for having this hearing. I'm curious, as usual, how do you wheel that dumb thing?
Mr. Westerling, could you show B how to wheel that thing?
So the wheels are on the back. There's a spot where you put your foot, and it very easily shifts back, and it's very well balanced, and it can be pushed very easily out to the curb.
I question it from someone like myself with balance problems. I'm trying to get it corrected, but I don't think that's going to correct me. You told me how much weight it's going to cut away. You stated that I'm in favor of staying my old way with my, I'm comfortable the way I've got. I guess I'm trying to teach an older person new ways. Forget it. I'm willing to try, but I don't, for safety wise, I've had some tumbles, and I don't want any more, thank you. You stated, Mr. Herr and Mr. Westerling, that if I opt or anybody opts to go to the old way, you contact E.L. Harvey. Do I get a telephone number, or I write, or how do I do this thing?
Through the chairman, there will be a telephone number at E.L. Harvey's to call, and you simply call them and say, I'm not interested, I'm opting out, please come collect your parts.
And I could continue, but I would not get any of these. I have to use my old way. The recycling one is the same way on it. I have a little homemade thing with wheels on it, and I pull it along. I'm not sure.
We'll try it out. Try it out.
My balance is not that hot.
Keep in mind that we are going to have available to you smaller versions of the recycling bin if you decide to get a smaller version.
It would be smaller.
It can be smaller.
It could be smaller.
What they're going to do is they're going to take these and distribute them throughout the community.
Yeah.
Okay? Everybody will get these. Okay? The second they show up on your doorstep or at your curbside and you don't want them, either one or both, you call a number that we will provide and say, please come take these back. I'm going to continue with my old process.
Is that a recycling 32. One, too?
This is 32. The 35-gallon. As I stated, you will receive up to a 64 for your trash. So this is 35 gallons.
That's for trash.
And this is 64 gallons for trash. The options for recyclables are any one of these three, so up to the 96 gallons for recyclables.
And you have to wheel the same way. I got to think about that.
But you can get two of those, right?
You can get three of those, right?
No, you can get of this right here, you can get one for recycling.
And two for trash.
And Mr. Westling, can you get two for trash or just one for trash?
For those folks that are not able to handle a larger one, they have specific needs, we can certainly work with E.L. Harvey.
That'll be another discussion with E.L. Harvey and Son. Okay.
Because of, what are they, 32 you said?
35.
35, so we're closer to the 70 cap.
We're going to stay with our typical process for a public hearing, okay? We can't get into a back and forth. We have someone at the microphone who's got some concerns. B, go ahead.
I'm going to have to go home, go back and think about this. But I am concerned of falling and that of the weight and having to learn a different method of pushing or pulling on it. I'll go home and think about it.
But okay.
My preference is the old way. Thank you.
I think B is an excellent example of how ideally this would get rolled out. She's going to think about what her options are for the containers. She's going to think about what she can or cannot handle or what she's interested in handling or not. And then she's going to let us know once we implement, if we implement, the process. So I think that what she just described right there should play out several times, many times around town. And wherever it plays out that people want to opt out, the contract will allow you to do so. No one is going to force you to do anything different. But we're going to encourage you to give it a shot. And then if it doesn't work, you let us know. And we'll fix it. Okay? Mr. Weissmantle.
Ken Weissmantle, 145 Ash Street. I think I support the proposal as it is, but what I think might be needed to be added to the overall trash collection thing is a opportunity to potentially take more trash directly to a to the Harvey location. For example, if I have a lot of recycling and, you know, have lots of big cardboard or something comes and, you know, I can go on a Saturday or whenever the attendant is open and drop off whatever recycling I want to do there, I think it would be a great benefit to the citizens of Hopkinton if you had a similar option where if you took the trash over there that they would, you know, collect it, you know, for those days that I can't fit everything in. And that's a rarity because there's only two of us left. But, for example, I just spent a lot of time cleaning out my mother's place in Florida. And, unfortunately, I had to toss a lot of stuff out that was very moldy, and it went out in the trash. And I mean, I recycled tons of paper, et cetera, too. But, you know, there was an awful lot of stuff that, you know, if I did it one barrel at a time, you know, it would take a year and a half to get there. But I think it's beneficial to give the people of Hopkinton more opportunities to get rid of trash legally rather than dumping it on, you know, open space, particularly some of the open space that I happen to own next to my house that routinely seems to collect stuff that people can't legally get rid of.
That's a great spot.
Thank you. Mr. Kamal. Mr. Kamal.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, Mr. Weisbender, your point is well taken. We can share with you that when we started these conversations, we were thinking along those lines. However, we hesitated going in that direction for fear that people may think that that's where the town is moving towards. But it's something that we are open to considering and discussing with ELRV.
Okay. Hang on one sec, please. I didn't ask the people join us at a line at the microphone, so I just want to come out to the audience before anyone else speaks twice to see if anyone else has something they'd like to say specific to it. Thanks, guys. You can come up next. Just let me.
I haven't spoken twice on this, just so you know.
You have spoken twice?
I have not.
Have you spoken once?
I have not.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, that was the other
word
thing. Okay. Good. Glad you spoke up. Go right ahead.
2 years ago, I think it was, that there was some discussion about the size of these trash barrels when there was this, and it was kind of put to bed. And Norman, I sent you a picture of the trash barrels that they use in Helena, Montana. I went looking for it. I don't have it anymore. Do you have that picture? These things are massive. I mean, I don't.
Doesn't look
it's
that
not
big
that big.
But I'll bring up your email.
I look at these. My daughter, some of you know, is barely 5 feet tall. I think she has to use a stick to push the lid open to throw her trash in them. And you know what? They're tough out in Montana. They don't complain.
Anything else? Okay, so first to the microphone.
Pam Waxlax, 15 Smith Road. So Mr. Herr knows I've been here since February talking about this. I am definitely in favor of this. And I just want to say, having two 80-plus-year-old parents, they handle both of these, the bigger one and the medium-sized one, getting their trash out over a public alley and through beech pine needles on a weekly basis. And they've not had any issues with the larger cans. And they found it actually easier. I'm hoping I get them too.
Thank you. Mr. Smith.
One thing I wanted to note, I've been watching the issue for the last several months and reading about it in the paper, and I noticed nowhere did it explain, I don't think you explained what is being done careful enough. In other words, what the people will lose or gain by it, whether you get, but tonight I just found out you can put out the additional large item, which wasn't in the paper. I think you'd need to do a little more in the paper or somehow get it out to people and explain exactly what each one will do, and I don't think it's been done adequately enough yet. And the second thing was to his comment about a large item. I don't want to put it out and kill these guys, but I'd like the ability to at least once a month or be able to take it to Hobbies without getting chaffed for it. I'll carry it over there, and I think a lot of people would do that. And instead of having it sit outside the road, which is an eyesore, or it'd help out a lot. I know in Westboro they can bring their trash, large items like that, and it doesn't cost them as a Westboro resident. So, you know, one item, you know, if we could be allowed to take something like that or be able to go over with it, an item and take it over and drop it off, it'd be helpful.
Mr. Westerling, do we have the option now, and will we have the option to take trash and recycling to the facility in Westboro?
Mr. Chairman, I believe that they will accept it now, but there's a fee. Because the way that it works now is if people put out an item or additional trash at the curb, when E.L. Harvey dumps that at Wheelabrator and Milbury, Milbury bills us directly for the tonnage. So if a resident brings it over to E.L. Harvey to dispose of it, there's no way for E.L. Harvey to track that and charge back to the town of Hopkinton. So they would charge the person who's bringing whatever the item is directly there at the scale.
Okay. And how about the question Mr. Smith raises, which I think is an excellent one in terms of communication. Assuming we nail down what the program's going to be in our July meeting after our colleagues get to see this input and we discuss it further, will E.L. Harvey be able to do some kind of communication with every resident in town as to what the program's going to be for the next 5 years? And
absolutely,
what the various things they can and cannot do in a document or some kind of mailing or something?
Absolutely, Mr. Chairman. E.L. Harvey is committed to rolling this out with public education behind it, what it looks like, what you'd be able to put in. Also, if people are looking for details, I did over an hour with HCAM at the studio where I went through all of the components of this system. We also have an frequently asked questions, which we can put online if it's not already. But we can put it online so that folks can look at, and it pretty well lays out all the components of the system.
And that HCAM broadcast is still in their library. You can go in and click on and watch that, correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. All right.
Mr. Kerr, am I allowed to ask a question?
Sure.
I just did.
That's your question.
Yeah.
Next.
So, Mr. Westerling, you said if this does come to fruition, these carts are going to be property of the town, correct?
No, I did not say that. There are two things. The trash carts will remain the property of E.L. Harvey, but we applied for a grant through DEP, which will bring back roughly $46,000 to the community. So the grant, if we're successful, will bring $10 per container for the recyclables. Those will become the property of the town of Hopkinton. As we're working with the contract, the responsibility for maintenance or repair or replacement of these carts is the responsibility of E.L. Harvey.
So will there be a spot on these carts that has the town seal? Like, I would like to see the town seal of Hopkinton on there rather than the Harvey name.
Absolutely. We can certainly emblem them however we wish. And they're also committed to the lid that you see on the 96-gallon container for recyclables is plain, but they're committed to stamping that with an imprint in the plastic of all those items that can be thrown in there. So if you forget, can I put a pizza box in there? If the pizza box doesn't appear on the lid, you cannot.
We have a lot of pizza. What can I say?
Okay. Any other members of the public want to address the issue? B, come on up.
That big one, that's, if one could, I have two small ones, I guess they're 35, which I managed to get with my own little system with the wheels. Could I get two of those small like that for my trash? And I don't know, that's awful hot, big for the recycle.
You can get a smaller recycling one.
Yeah.
And you can get a smaller trash one too.
Yeah, but I'm used to putting with my two small ones like that for my trash.
She can't.
And that. I'm going to have to call him and think about that one.
Yeah. Okay.
Also, through the chair, these carts are here in the town hall, so if at your convenience or anyone's convenience, if they want to come up, look at them, try to lift them, try to roll them, please feel free.
The issue is the rolling and balance.
I understand.
I have enough trouble right now with my balance, thank you.
Okay. Damaged ones will be replaced by E.L. Harvey anytime they get damaged.
The homeowner will not get charged for any repairs or replacement. So what E.L. Harvey will come out, if the wheel is damaged, they will look to repair that initially. If it's beyond repair, then they will replace at no cost to the town or the homeowner.
Mr. Deeks.
This is a little detail. I should know the answer, but I don't.
Right now, we have the ability to put 4x4 squares out. Like, for example, I threw out some rug remnants, and I put them into 4-foot rolls, and Harvey takes them. Is that going to continue?
Mr. Westerling.
I mean, that was not a bulk pickup. The guy who goes around with a truck picked them up, took them away.
Three, Mr. Chairman, any residential trash that's left at the curb, Eel Harvey has been very cooperative in collecting anything that's out, and will continue to do so, as long as it's residential trash.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anybody else?
And Mr. Chair?
Sure.
Hi there, my name is Robert Falcioni, and I have a business in town. I live here in town. I sleep elsewhere, but I'm pretty much in town all the time. And a two-household, two-member household finds that very adequate. No matter how much you put in these containers, they're easy to roll because they're well-balanced once you pull them back. And it's great if you have a cat and you want to feed the cat without the dogs getting at the food. You just put the food on top and nobody's going to bother it because they can't reach it. But the cat can. So I'm totally and like to let people know just that my testimony is that it's a great idea, I think, for the town and a great idea for individuals and families.
Thank you.
The crows.
No back and forth.
So Mr. Kamala has a picture up. I'm not sure what it is.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, with gratitude to Ed Harrow, I'm pleased to display the trash carts that he shared with us.
They look like little Volkswagen cars. Okay. Anyone else want to offer any comments to the board specific to the trash and recycling? Mrs. Wright.
I would just like to suggest that perhaps at the close of this public hearing, when we move on to another item, perhaps Mr. Westerling would take these barrels and put them out in the hall so that folks could, rather than having to come up here, they might try them out as they leave the hearing.
It's fine with me. Mr. Westerling.
Happy to do that. They're very easy to move.
Okay. All right. Any other input during the public hearing part of the process? So let me just describe what would happen next. We would vote to close the public hearing. Does that mean we won't accept any more emails about trash and recycling? No. Does that mean we won't accept any more input while we're out and about in town about trash and recycling? No. Does that mean we're going to deliberate and make a decision tonight? No. Okay. We've had some opportunity for everybody to give input. We've got a ton of email about it. I can tell you that 90% of the emails I've received, 95% have been in favor of the program. Okay, especially now that it's constituted in such a way that you can opt out. Okay, so I think the community has come around from where we were 3 months ago when there was a lot of concern. We'll close the public hearing tonight. We'll continue to have dialogue, obviously. You can continue to weigh in on it. And at our July 12th meeting, I believe it is, our colleagues will have watched this public hearing, and then we're going to try and make a decision that night as to whether to move forward or not. Okay, everybody understand where we are? Everybody good? Mr. Kamala, are you good?
Again, we're very grateful to the community for the input that they've provided so far on this topic.
Okay, so with that, the chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing specific to the trash and recycling contract renewal.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, a motion and a second to close the hearing. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so for now, what we'll do with that, it's unanimous and so carries. With that, we'll continue the discussion to another time at our next meeting when we have a full board. Okay? Thank you all very much for your input. Next up, and we're running a little behind here, but we can make up some ground, I think, this evening. And Chief, I'll get to you as soon as I can. I apologize. We have the Hopkinton Sustainable Green Committee is here. And they're going to give us a brief update on the status of the LED streetlight project, another environmentally, in my view anyway, another environmentally sound task for the town to address. Mr. Doyle is here, and I believe some other members. So if you guys would just say hello and introduce yourself and tell us what's up.
All right.
How you doing? Aubrey Doyle, 38 Elm Street, Sustainable Green Advisory Committee. I guess it's technically what we are now. And we're working with, and myself and John Kane are working with Dave on the LED streetlight project, which was approved 2 years ago, town meeting. So just a couple things here. Budget, $175K. We're looking at running certainly within budget for the project. We currently have six samples out around town, two down at the Cedar Street intersection near the post office, two at Center School, and two at the Sanctuary Lane intersections. And they're all different different wattage, different power, but you can see it's about the same light. You see the same distribution of light as you do with the normal lights, with the standard lights. So those have been up for a couple weeks, and to date have not heard any feedback, negative feedback, I would say. I would assume people wouldn't comment otherwise. The payback on this, just so you're aware, 8-year payback period on the lighting as currently constituted, and is at the bottom of the screen, it's about 550 lights total that will be replaced. Don't know if there's any questions on that. Schedule-wise,
Aubrey, on the 8-year payback, does that include the rebate, or is that outside the rebate?
Yes.
Okay.
Next screen, if we can go through. So schedule-wise, as I said, we have a couple. We have some samples up, basically looking for approval by the end of the month of June, so that we can move forward. There's a DOR review process. There's a lot of time involved, including from ordering materials. So if we get all those approvals done essentially by the end of June, we'd be looking to start installation around the first, second week of October, complete around the just before Thanksgiving, and then final completion end of year, finishing up punch list items. So that's high level kind of where we are. John, you want to add a few
Just basically, the ESCO that we're working with just completed a project in Sudbury. I took a drive through Sudbury, similar, in fact, the same make and model of lamps, similar scope of the project, positive feedback in the town. I have a place in Dennis in the Cape. They swapped out the lights about 3 years ago. There's one right outside my window. I didn't even notice it until about 6 months ago, when I started talking to the town to get feedback from them, and realized for the last 3 years there's been an LED lamp there. So it's the sort of thing that, unless you're looking for it, you won't really notice. The light quality is described as moonlight. The DEP, the feedback from DEP was that it's better to work under in the winter, you know, when they're doing snow removal and such. But other than that, it's really the biggest difference is the cost efficiency, mainly. That's all I have.
So I think it's a great idea. Full disclosure, I have nothing to do with this project, obviously. Nothing. But many people in town know I'm in the electrical business, and I probably literally sold 1 million plus LED. We call them lamps, not light bulbs, because the light bulb manufacturers get bent out of shape when you call it a light bulb. We call them lamps. In my life, millions and millions of these things. 10 years ago, an LED light was a very bright, white, harsh, nasty light. And if we put it outside your bedroom window 10 years ago, you would have been calling the town, like, what in the heck is this thing out here? Now, the color rendering, which is the sort of the, it's much softer, it's much warmer now. I mean, all the color lights you see all over the globe today are LEDs, and you can change the color rendering quite easily. So I think it's a great project for the town. The residents, unless they're lamp geeks like me, are not going to notice the difference in the color. Maintenance-wise, these things go in for 25 years. You don't have to touch them, many of them. And cost-wise, it's about, 40%, 30% of what you'd been paying before in terms of, because of consumption, comes way down. So it's great for the environment, and safety-wise, everything else, I think it's a great project.
Sounds like a no-brainer.
Mrs. Wright.
Well, I do have a few comments because I'm not a lighting geek, but on the planning board, I kind of got the reputation of being the lighting witch or something that rhymed with that word. Princess, that's right. To Mr. Hurst's point, when I think LED, I do think of some of these incredibly searingly bright. There is a quality about the LED that isn't able to be modulated the same way a more traditional bulb is. I do understand, I've been to lighting workshops, that it has, there have been a lot of advances. They are not a shielded type of a light fixture, so it has to be put in it, or the fixture has to be such that you aren't going to get that glare in your eye. So I was looking at your schedule and noticing that there were sample fixtures and there was a time for approvals. I would like to know who gives those approvals, and these samples that are on Cedar Street at Center School and Sanctuary, are these different types of fixtures or different types of wattage? I'd like to understand the process for viewing and deciding on the options, because I am concerned, also having served on design review and on planning board, where we spent a lot of time trying to work a lighting bylaw to get lighting that would not be intrusive. And LED has that potential to be very intrusive. I want to make sure we have a chance to view the color, the intensity, the type of fixture, and how well shielded it is.
So let me just jump in real quick before we go too far down the path.
What is the approval process?
I'm not convinced that we're going to approve anything. I don't think we even vote on this. So, Mr. Kamal.
One of the reasons why Dave and the advisory team are before the board is to receive any suggestions in terms of who we can talk to. There's no formal approval that is expressly required, but if there are suggestions that perhaps we take the design of the fixtures to the design review board to discuss the design, I think that's a welcome suggestion. If there's also a suggestion that we follow whatever the town process is in discussing spillage, we will gladly do so. To Brian's point, there's really no formal process set in town for this approval.
Well, you know, Mr. Hurd just mentioned the differences in color, which is true. So how do we get assurance that the color we get is the color we want?
So let's do this, but let's keep it at the board level for a moment. We don't vote on this.
No.
So if we don't vote on it and you have specific questions you want to ask and specific concerns that I think are valid, by the way, you need to take those to these folks directly. We don't need to do that here. We can't do that here for a couple of reasons. So are you okay with that? I don't mean to dismiss what you're saying. I'm just saying
I want the town to have some oversight. I'd like design review to take a look at the fixture.
So, okay, but let's
like some input on the color.
What we can't do as a board,
right?
Okay, members can do what they want, but what we can't do as a board is overstep our bounds.
No, I understand that, but there was reference made to approvals.
Right, that's the Department of Energy Resources, the DOER, that does the approvals for the fixtures and the rebates and all that happens at the state level. It doesn't happen at the town level. The planning board, I would think, has some role in this process because we're doing stuff in the public domain specific to safety and lighting and things like that, which the planning board has oversight over. But we as a board of selectmen don't have any oversight.
No,
they're giving this update to us.
Correct. No, I understand, and I wasn't asking. I was asking a broad question about where does the approval or the oversight lie so that we can impact that.
Mr. Del Torio, can you answer that question for Mrs. Wright?
Who has approval? Well, the process, we went through an RFQ process, an RFP process through the regional, MAPC. In that process, it was there were several communities included in that. And as part of that process, the vendors submitted manufacturer types and lamp types. So there was three different lamp types that the vendors submitted to the Sustainable Green Committee, Aubrey and John and myself, and we picked the three out of the three which one we we thought match the existing the best, the existing lamps that are out there. The wattage also matched the existing wattage that was out there, and the light coverage from these fixtures are supposed to, you know, stay within, you know, the existing kind of coverage of the existing light. So the goal in what we've been, you know, moving under is keeping everything pretty much as close to what's there. If there's an existing 100-watt lamp, it would be changed to a 35, and that would be throughout. And that's the closest to what a 100-watt regular street light would throw, the 35 would, or 53.
Okay, but in terms of the approval process, and I think that's where we're...
Where do you take your concerns?
Focus. Where does this member of the Board of Selectmen take her concerns specific to this project? Mr. Kamal.
If I may, tonight I have heard your concern being, is there a process for receiving input in terms of the design selection? And I think the suggestion I'm hearing is that perhaps we can receive that input from the design review committee. We will do that.
Okay.
We're not necessarily assigning the design review body approval authority. Town meeting authorized this project already.
Right.
And in a collaborative effort, which is what we have always done, we will go to the design review board and ask for their input on the three fixtures that are available for selection.
And color.
Yes. I've also heard you reference light spillage or pollution. I'm sure there's a process we'll discuss with the land. There's a process that the town uses in reviewing that issue. We will engage Elaine on that topic. But what I'm hearing already from Dave is that the fixtures that are proposed do not exceed what is currently in place. If there are opportunities to improve, we will certainly look into that.
Okay.
Okay. So I don't mean to cut this off, but this was an informative or informational presentation. Again, the board has no role in this necessarily or authority specific to this project. You've heard some concerns from Mrs. Wright. I think she's been very consistent in her concerns in her years volunteering in the community with respect to light spillover and so forth. I have the same concerns. I personally like LED. I think a lot of the is that you were referencing is was. There's a lot that's changed. It changes every day. But this is not the forum for that debate. No, I think if you've got concerns, you should take them directly to those folks through the town manager. Mr. Kamalo.
Just want to throw this out, too, for this the public as well as the new board members. I like the numbers that I saw in terms of the payback. I think there's also another number that we need to add to the dollar amounts identified. Namely, you will recall that this whole project came about as a result of ongoing discussions with the Sustainable Green in terms of how can we continue to pursue the green agenda. In addition, it's also a project that we're doing to resolve the violation that the town was found guilty on at 21 Miserve in terms of disposing asbestos. And the minimum of that fine was 25,000. And I think there was an additional, don't remember the exact amount, but with this project, implementing this project will therefore get rid of that a sanction from DEP.
Mr. Tedstone, we've had a lot of discussion.
I'm good.
You good?
You guys summed it right up for me.
All right, excellent. Okay, with that, thank you very much, Mr. Doyle.
Yeah, and just make one comment. I would ask that you do take a look at the samples that are out there so you get a feel for what we're proposing so we get a little better handle on that.
I have a pretty good feel for which direction Mrs. Wright's going to go home tonight. Okay, with that, we need to move on, folks. Thank you very much for coming in tonight, and we look forward to it. Okay, next up, Chief Lee is going to address the board and give us an update on three specific items, an alcohol compliance check operation that was conducted on June 9th, 2016. He's also going to address the Hopkinton Center for the Arts question or concern, as well as the last place served report that came from the state recently to the town of Hopkinton. Chief Lee.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Do you mind if I do it in any particular order?
Not at all. Whatever is comfortable for you.
First, let me start by letting everyone know that the Attorney General's office issues a list to all cities and towns. There's a general law which the courts are required, usually in a plea bargain situation, where was the last place that you consumed alcohol. That information is given to the cities and towns. Not much is given. You will get a date, a time, and a docket number, which but no name of the suspect. But you are given the establishment in the town of Hopkinton. This is since 2013. We've had three. Two of them was the same restaurant, Quattro, on 12/30/2015, and also on 9/18/2015. Now, we were able to look at our reports that day on our computer system and see that there were only one arrest for DUI, and we were able to determine what occurred there. One of the arrests at Quattro was a female, and she was just at the legal limit of 0.08, which 1 point lower, she wouldn't have been charged. So with my experience, I would think this may be something that we need to talk to Quattro about. Someone at that level is not always the easiest detect when they're serving. So it might turn into an educational situation. The other arrest, it comes into question whether or not on 9/18/2015, if the person actually went to Quattro at that last location. Reading the officer's report, a BOLO, which is a information coming out from other towns, it was given that the drunk driver was coming in off of Route 85 from Milford, and the person was actually stopped on, I believe, West Main Street before that establishment. So we'd have to dig a little bit further into that, and then there'd certainly be some question of whether or not, you know, the person just gave that information, but it doesn't sound like they came from that establishment unless they were there earlier in the day. And the final one is Dynasty Restaurant. Like I say, we don't get much information other than the date it happened on, and this occurred on 2/12/16, and the arrest was from another police department. So we are still in the process of researching that and to see what exactly the circumstances were, and we are trying to get that information through the courts. They make it clear that some of the information is not complete, and also that the information does not constitute any accusation of criminal negligent conduct by any establishment. It is not meant to be suitable for your license monitoring and your enforcement practices. The Attorney General has not conducted any independent interview or information. It does not require defendant statements about these establishments to be made under oath. So with that being said, we will look into these incidents and if we can dig up any other information, but a lot of it is mostly making people aware and making these establishments aware that their names did come up, and it would go along with our enforcement activities. Now, moving on to the enforcement activities, we received the...
Chief, can I stop you there for 1 sec? So specific to the last place served, there's two names in Hopkinton.
Yes.
Both Quattro and the Dynasty. Have you gone or have you asked someone from your team to go and check in with the owners of the establishments and let them know that this has happened, that we got this report?
Not yet, but it will be part of our ongoing commitment. But getting to the next part, we wanted to do this enforcement activity because it was only a few days later after receiving this information, and we didn't want to tip off any establishments that.
Okay, so before you move to the next item, does anybody have any comments specific to the last place served and chiefs going out to visit them and talking?
Nope.
Okay. All right. Next item, please.
As I said before, in our continuance to the importance of making sure establishments are, one, not over-serving people, And we've certainly shown a pattern of that, and the board has been very supportive, and we certainly appreciate that, and I'm sure everyone in town does. Also, the dangers of people serving underage drinkers. On Thursday, June 9th, 2016, the Hopkinton Detective Unit conducted an alcohol compliance check. In the operation, we utilized two undercover females in an undercover capacity. Their identification was checked to confirm their age. Both were administered a PBT, which is a portable breath test, to ensure that they weren't consuming alcohol themselves. And at the conclusion of the operation, to confirm that the undercover females obviously did not consume alcohol. During the operation, every establishment in Hopkinton that sells an alcoholic beverage was approached by both or one of the females. The only exceptions were two establishments in town. I'll probably hold off on identifying them, but they will eventually be checked in a timely manner. Every tested establishment, with the exception of the Dynasty restaurant, refused service to the undercover minors, which is good news. It is also noteworthy that Buffalo Burgers bartender brought the undercover a Bud Light and opened it. However, the bartender did request an ID before leaving the drink, kind of had a second thought about it, and brought it back. And obviously, we will be handling that situation in a educational manner. It probably shouldn't have got to that point. And the detectives did inform them of the situation.
A bison burger?
Yeah, bison burger, absolutely.
Which is the same ownership as Quattro.
Yeah.
Okay. And at the point when they did not produce an ID, they removed. Now, in the case of the Dynasty, at 1946 hours, the undercover entered the restaurant and waited at the bar. The undercover was approached by the bartender and requested a Bud Light. The bartender opened up the bottle of Bud Light and placed it in the oven in front of the undercover and walked away. At that time, as the undercover was instructed, left the unconsumed beer on the bar and left the establishment. The undercover immediately reported what happened to Detective Burchard and also Detective Greg DeBoer. The undercover further described the bartender that served her. Both Burchard and DeBoer went into the Dynasty, spoke to the female manager. The female bartender was brought over to the lobby. This person exactly fit the description the undercovers described, and the bartender was identified as Donna Aldrich. The manager and the bartender were advised that of the violation, and it would be forwarded to the chief of police and then forwarded to the board.
Okay. Thoughts, comments on this particular scenario?
I think that it shows, with the exception of the Dynasty, it shows that there's pretty good follow-through on compliance. With all the other establishments in town. And I think that's what I think.
Thank you. Mrs. Wright.
Have there been similar instances with that one particular establishment on other checks? How often do you do these undercover checks, number one, and has there been any kind of a pattern within that one establishment of violations up before this that you're aware of?
On the Dynasty, I do believe there was one in the past prior to my arriving as chief of police, but I would have to confirm that before I say that. There were other minor violations when our officers went in to inspect the Dynasty in the past. As far as keeping the blinds open and showing alcohol being consumed, the things that we check for, some minor things that they were warned of. But as far as them failing a test through undercovers, I'll have to verify that. But I, and not that I'm being unprepared, I thought that this was an introduction, and then we would move to have a some type of hearing where we'd get all that information for you.
And with what frequency does the police department do these undercover checks, roughly?
First of all, the first aspect of it is on a yearly basis, but first is the educational part of it. We try to bring everybody in. We offer all the establishments a chance, for bad ID identification, teaching everyone about over-serving, and things of that nature. And then we usually wait a few months after that information is given out, and then we move on compliance.
Mr. Kamalo, I'll sit. Sorry. Mr. Kamalo, when we when we address a concern that's brought to our attention by public safety specific to alcohol being served and a license associated with it, is that a public hearing when we do that?
It depends on the decision made by the board. Chief brings an issue to the board's attention, and if the board determines that there's a need to hold a public hearing, then the board can schedule that public hearing.
Can we process, or can we consider any kind of disciplinary action without a public hearing?
No.
So we need the public hearing for any disciplinary action. Okay, that's what I was trying to figure out. And I know we've, I just don't know how we've been doing the ones we've done lately. So specific to this issue, which I think is tied to the first issue, at least there's a couple of data points there where they're consistent in terms of names of establishments. Well, a couple of things. One, we have a lot of very responsible, solid business people in the community of Hopkinton that have these types of licenses that obviously tested well in this particular exercise, with one making a mistake and another almost making a mistake and correcting midstream. So I appreciate correcting midstream, but still, it wasn't exactly the way it's supposed to be done. But we have all kinds of other people doing it right, at least in terms of this check.
Absolutely.
But to be consistent with how this board handles all issues with respect to alcohol licenses, I think we need to, specific to the two establishments where there was a where there was a problem, minor in one case, major in another case, I think we need to ask those folks to come before us and talk, because that's what we've told everybody that's come before us, that asked for all these new licenses all over town, including tonight.
Yep.
We're not going to take this stuff lying down, right? So we're going to be managing aggressively our responsibility here and providing the leadership to the community that's just not tolerated. So that said, I'll get off my soapbox. I would suggest that we ask that we bring those two establishments before the board, I think in a public hearing format, to discuss the incident. The chief will present it, the person will have an opportunity to respond, and then we'll close it, we'll do it, get the public input if there is any, and then we'll do some deliberation about what we think we should do. But I think both of these situations merit a minimum of conversation with the license holder.
I think that's a good idea, the way we set the tone, and it's consistent with everybody and every issue.
Do you agree with that, Chief?
Absolutely.
Would that be what you're looking for?
Absolutely. That's
specific to the check operation.
Yes.
How about the first thing you described, the last place served information? Does that warrant, think, a hearing?
I think the way that the information is given out, and then you really wouldn't have the opportunity to bring that suspect in who was actually arrested, already pled out.
So you wouldn't have the evidence necessarily.
You wouldn't have the evidence, but it's enough to warrant a sit down and get my detectives over there and say, hey, listen.
So you go see them on those particular
issues.
Exactly.
Your name showed up on this list twice. You know, we get, and explain that,
And then
people are watching, and people are going to give the information out at the time of their arrest. And I know people might be thinking, well, why didn't the Hopkinton PD ask that question? Well, if you look at reports, most of the time when people are arrested for a DUI, they ask for an attorney and they don't speak, or they're not going to relay the information that they're at a certain place drinking. It's usually denial. that they were doing. So the officers do ask that information as well.
Like so you'll go talk to the folks specific to the first thing. We already talked about that. I think we're all in agreement that we would like to see the license holders come before us with a public hearing format to address these concerns and see what the board's position is going to be on those particular two incidents. It's a little bit telling that they are also in the first discussion we had this evening with the chief. And then we go from there. Mr. Kamal, do you agree with all that?
Saved. I think a conversation between the board and the licensee is appropriate. I'm not so sure whether that discussion rises to the level of what the board would do if there's an apparent violation.
Okay, so given the circumstances that we have based on his presentation this evening, we can do that at the same time we do the other thing, which is the check of operations, or the operations check.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. But you're just saying in general, if this comes up, we should have a conversation. I guess if we're going to be consistent and not be mamby-pamby about it, we need to deal with everybody where there's some kind of concern. Okay? And then, Chief, you have a third item. So, Mr. Kamal, you're going to schedule those?
Yes, we will.
Okay.
Thank you. The third thing involving the Hopkinton Center for the Arts is I received information that there was a party on June 3rd that was serving alcohol, and I was not aware of it. I know the license was aware of it, and I don't believe the town was aware of it. So I took the opportunity to call Ms. Grill, the coordinator, and she, in fact, did say that there was an event there, but it was under her understanding that because it was a private party with a private caterer, that they did not have to notify the police or the town. That communication was sent to Mr. Kamalo, who corrected her and let her know that the licensed caterer is required to send a written notice of the event to the police chief and the board at least 48 hours prior to the event, including the following: a copy of the caterer's ABCC license, proof of liquor liability insurance, emergency contact information of the manager of the catering company. And in this case, the licensed caterer did not provide the above listed to the board of selectmen or the police chief. On later date, June 7th, I received another email from Ms. Grill saying, thank you, Diane Peppers. Diane from Peppers Catering Company would be contacting myself, and she stated that they usually contact the police department with 48 hours prior to an event, and not sure why it didn't happen. They get forward a copy of their license as well. And that's to this date, I have not heard anything from Pepper's Catering. And I also sent that information on June 7th, let Mrs. Grill know. I have not heard from the catering company. And I'm not quite sure if the town has heard anything.
Mr. Kamal, have we heard anything in town hall specific to this?
No, we did not receive any specific notice. I can share with the board that I'm currently in conversations with the HCA regarding a formal sit-down where at least we can begin some formal discussion as to how we can manage this process going forward.
Okay. Chief, do you have a request of the board specific to this situation?
Well, in light of the ongoing concerns for the Performing Arts Center. I just think it's kind of a bad start with the communication and not a total understanding of what the rules are in place now. And you know, my concern would be, Is this going to be a patent when and if they get their full alcohol license?
Yeah, so,
and I'm sure my colleagues know this, but maybe some at home don't. The Hopkinton Center for the Arts has previously applied for an all-alcohol license for the facility, much like what we talked about earlier tonight with another applicant. That application, we had a public hearing on that, and that application was not approved at that time because we were trying to sort out what was going to go on at the venue and what were the hours going to be and what was going to be served. And so we had a lot of questions, and so we didn't get it resolved. And so it's sort of pending. It's still kind of hanging out there. I know they're actively trying to move that forward sort of from their perspective and then come back to us. I'm not sure what they're going to come back with, if they're going to modify anything or not. So we have this ongoing, to the chief's point, process. Okay. But they don't hold a license today. You know, our position has always been with everybody, like we're going to do with these two tonight, and whoever comes before us, don't mess up. We're going to talk if you do. These folks don't hold a license yet. So my question is, like, what is it appropriate in this situation in your mind, Mr. Camallo, do you think?
I think based on the prior discussions between the board and the HCA, although the HCA does not currently hold a license, the medium for discussing this very issue could be based on the current lease agreement between the town and the HCA. And so in planning for my conversations with the HCA, I'm hoping to use the lease as the basis for this discussion.
And to use the lease as the basis for the discussion, which I think is an excellent point and something that is also of concern to many in this situation in front of us, not the lease in general, does that require a public hearing?
At this point, I would recommend to the board that you consider taking this issue under advisement. Allow us to have further conversations with the ACA, and we will then report back to the board what the next steps could be.
Okay, I understand. Mrs. Wright.
I have a question, and bear with me because I'm new to all this alcohol licensing procedures. At our last meeting, I recalled that there was a one-day alcohol license issued to an applicant for a daughter's wedding. And at St. John's, and she too had a caterer that would be serving that had all the appropriate certifications. But even though it was going to be served by an approved certified caterer, we still issued a one-day license. In this case, I'm hearing that all this particular caterer was required to do would have been to 48 hours in advance provide documentation of their credentials. Why would they not also have to have had a one-day liquor license if the caterer for St. John's doing the wedding had to?
Through the chair, there's a distinction between caterers who can distribute alcohol and caterers who do not have the ability to distribute alcohol.
Different types of catering licenses?
Yes.
So you were saying,
in the sale of alcohol at an event versus the distribution or the giving of alcohol at an event is also different. Is that correct?
Yeah, the sale and the distribution. Right. So I'm assuming, I don't remember the specifics regarding the one-day liquor license application for St. John's, whether the caterer had the authorization from the ABCC to sell and distribute alcohol. I don't recall that.
But they were going to be the ones doing it. We gave a license. But it was the caterer that was going to be doing it, because remember we asked about their tip certification and all the rest, that they had all the qualifications. I guess I'm just questioning whether there was actually a one-day liquor license that should have been issued to the HCA caterer. I'd be interested in looking into the difference between the two cases and see if there is even more that was required of the HCA caterer than just the 48 hours based on the type of a requirement for the caterer at St. John's, who apparently also had the serving qualifications. Just asking.
Yeah. I can report to the board. I'm familiar with the specifics regarding the HCA caterer. That caterer did have the license from the ABCC to sell and distribute alcohol.
Okay, so what do you guys think of Mr. Kamala's suggestion that we just sort of table this for now and let our professional team go do a little bit more work and have a little bit more communication and then come back to us with what they think next step should be?
Sounds reasonable. Yeah.
With the exception of, what if this HCA wanted to have a 500-person wedding every single week from now till this thing's done by Peppers running their, I mean, they have to let you know 2 days in advance. They could be having 500-person weddings every single weekend as long as they let you know by Thursday at 3 o'clock that they're going to be having this. Why is there not like a moratorium until this is, while you're working on it, You can't just give them just say, go do what you want to do.
Yes. At this point, I don't believe there are any functions that are planned planned at the HCA. We have communicated the town's position as that if they are to hold a private function, they do require the selectman's approval to do so. Their legal counsel has a different take on it. But I think these are issues that we want to discuss. Your point is well taken. We want to confirm. We will confirm based on your comment that there are no other large events that are planned for
private or public. I mean, what's to say they don't say, I'm going to have an Easter egg hunt for the kids in July, and Peppers is going to go ahead and your kids are going to go find an Easter egg, but we're going to give you all this hooch. There's nothing really. In an extreme version of it, there's no way to stop them at this point, correct?
I think we've communicated to the HCA that at least two things, that if they are to hold private functions outside what the town believes to be allowed in the lease agreement, that they will require the Board of Selectmen's approval. And then secondly, to your point, if there is going to be any saving of alcohol, either in a public or private event, that would require a one-day liquor license.
But it wouldn't. Right now, they can hire Peppers to come in and let you know Thursday at 3 o'clock, that's Saturday at 3 o'clock, on this public event, this blade of grass counting party that they're going to have. They're going to have, you know, 50 kegs of alcohol they're going to hand out.
We will look into that. I see that window.
It's an extreme point, but it's a point that has the possibility to gain legs, I would think.
So are we okay with tabling it?
Yep.
I'll make one
yep.
quick comment to sort of wrap it up if I could then. You know, the HCA is a great asset to Hockington. They've done an incredible amount of work over there. They've been spent a great deal of money. They've raised an awful lot of money, private funds, to make this happen. It's a great venue for Hockington and a great organization. We're in a little bit of a tough spot right now as we try to work through where we are with this lease situation, how the lease situation impacts the ability to host certain types of events, and then the liquor license that's associated with all that. So we're in a little bit of a tough spot that is in no means a reflection on, you know, how much the community values the HCA, but we do have to just all have some patience and work through this as best we can. It is a little messy right now. And frankly, I think it's a little unfortunate that as we're trying to get going, to the chief's point, that this is the way we start. So I love it over there. I'm confident we're going to find a solution here. We haven't found it yet, but we do need to be very careful as we move forward because it has gotten off to a bit of a rough start.
Yep. Okay. And I don't mean to say that I don't love it either.
I understand.
I'm just saying conceptually.
Yeah.
And I would add, Mr. Herr, that we've just in the previous discussions basically set a zero tolerance policy.
Right.
That we're not going to mess around on even the smallest thing. And this is a town-owned property. There are optics involved to the public of the rules that apply to everyone else should not be applied differently to anything that is town-related. And
totally
we need to be alert to that because there are some serious public optics.
Yep, absolutely. Okay, so with that, Mr. Kamala, Chief, you guys can come back to us on this particular issue in the near future. Okay,
thanks, Chief.
Moving right along, next on the agenda is board liaison assignments. So here's what I would like to try and do. And Mr. Kamala, do you have a copy of this in front of you as well? Maria, I think, did a nice job preparing it. And I'm just going to go right down the list. And I have two members here. And Mr. Kamala, if you could be Mr. Catino, and Mrs. Lazarus, if you could be Mr. Sestari, and everybody, as I read the name, just speak up if you want it, okay? And we can be very flexible here and get this resolved quickly. I really, with all due respect, do not want to get into individual debates on every committee. Let's just make a decision and move on, or we could be here for a week. So with that sort of backdrop and lack of patience on my part, I apologize in advance. Accounting, Mr. Kamala, that's you, not Mr. Catino.
Different hat.
Appropriations Committee, Mr. Kamala. Again, if somebody wants to jump in on some of this, even though they say his name, feel free, okay? Board of Assessors, that's myself. Treasurer Collector's Office, Mr. Kamala. Town Manager's Budget Advisory Team, what is that?
It's an informal setup that we have had run before.
Me. That's me.
Yeah, you got it.
Okay. So you guys are keeping track of this over there, so you can give it to Maria, right? Capital Improvement Committee, Mr. Sestari. Cable Advisory Committee, Mr. Kamala. Kamala, if there's some of these you need to shed for whatever reason, don't be shy. Public Safety, and that's just a category. Animal Control Officer, Mr. Kamala. Okay, back up. So we're going to have another column here for Elaine.
Uh-oh.
And this is Elaine, right? Not Elaine Sestari.
Elaine Actual.
Elaine's got Animal Control Officer.
Fuck you, Elaine.
Fire Department. I see Mr. Catino checked off here. And I see Police Department, Mr. Catino checked off here. Does anybody have any other thoughts on that?
Is that appropriate for him to do both, or is it, I mean, if he has the time to do it, great, but is it appropriate for him to do both of those?
Yeah.
I think over the years, we've been looking for opportunities to define police and fire as public safety, and I think having one board member as the liaison to both, I think, allows for that thinking to progress.
Let me just stop real quick and just say one thing specific to liaison assignments. The liaison assignment, as the modern Board of Selectmen would describe it, and I think at least with the other sort of tenured members, is, and your predecessors as well, a liaison to a board or committee in town is just that. It is not a member of that board or committee, and it is not an expectation of this board that you attend those meetings regularly and participate in their discussion. You are available to facilitate any dialogue between them and us, or them and anyone else in the community that you feel that you can do it. But there's been sometimes a perception or a misperception that the liaison is the person from the Board of Selectmen that will be there and carry the water and do all the work. You know, it's one-on-one constantly. You would have no life, okay? And you wouldn't be very good at this job either because you'd be sleeping on the desk while we're doing it.
Yep.
Our meetings. So the liaison is just that. It's somebody that they can reach out to, that is assigned to them, that they should expect a return phone call or email from, etc. But please don't think it's something that you or your colleagues, so you can't say to Todd, well, you're the liaison of fire, how come you haven't been in the, you know, fire truck the last 6 weeks? That's not the job.
Yep.
Okay, so just to throw that out there. So we're down through permitting now. Board of Appeals, Mr. Catino.
Yes.
Conservation Commission,
me.
Mr. Ted Stone, planning board, Mrs. Wright, you okay with that?
Yep.
Inspectional services, Mr. Kamalo.
Elaine Lane.
Elaine Lane. Board of Health, Mr. Catino. In terms of numbers, too, we want to try and balance this out, okay? The chair sometimes takes a little bit lighter load on liaisons because the chair is liaisoning with the town manager's office on a daily basis and some other stuff. So just kind of keep a track of the numbers here a little bit, too. Planning board, we covered. Inspection, Elaine Lane. Board of Health, Mr. Catino. Permanent Building Committee, Mr. Sestari. School committee, myself, and that's typically the chair, okay? Does anyone have a strong opinion on that?
Nope.
Okay. Regional Vocational Technical School.
Me.
Mr. Ted Stone.
Alma mater.
Engineering Facilities Department. Is that Mr. Kamalo?
Yes.
Okay. Cemetery Commission. That's me, Mrs. Wright.
Well, I'm still on that, so that wouldn't work for me.
What's that?
It works.
Is that appropriate?
Yeah,
to be a member as well as?
I mean, I'll take it. All right. I thought
I think
that
it makes sense,
thing.
Frankly.
Okay.
It's just an efficiency thing.
All right. Yep.
So scratch me, and that goes to Mrs. Wright. Town Clerk's Office, Mr. Kamalo. Personnel yes. Committee, Mr. Kamalo. Council on Aging, that is me. Veterans Services.
I would take that.
Yeah, Mr. Kamala, wasn't that Mr. Palaco in the past?
Veteran services in general in town, yes. However, this was focusing on the Metro West Veterans Board.
Oh, that's the Veterans Celebration Committee.
Yes.
Okay, I got you. All right, so Veterans Services, Mr. Kamala. ADA Oversight Committee. Mr. Sestari, Veterans Celebration Committee.
I'll take that.
So,
Brendan wants
Mr. Ted Stone.
You're good with that?
Yep. Marathon Committee. I'm happy to take
you
that.
Where'd tax relief go?
Oops, sorry. Tax relief. I didn't see a thing. Tax Relief
Nobody.
Committee.
What is that?
There is a committee that looks into opportunities for relieving the tax burdens on the most needy members of the community.
I'll take that if you want me to.
Mrs. Wright will take the tax committee, relief committee. Marathon committee is myself, if everybody's okay with that. Uh-huh. Public library.
Me.
Mr. Ted Stone. Everybody good with that? Uh-huh. Parks and Recreation. Mr. Sestari, Youth Commission, Mr. Sestari, Community Preservation, Mrs. Wright, Woodville Historic District Commission, Mrs. Wright, Historical Commission.
May I wrestle that away from you, Mr. Herr?
You may. Mrs. Wright, Historic District Commission, Mrs. Wright. Other, Commissioner of Trust Funds, Mr. Kamalo. What is the Commissioner of Trust, I mean, I don't know what the Commissioners of Trust Funds is. Do you have a suggestion on that one?
Yeah, in fact, we've been giving that responsibility more to the finance director and the town treasurer and collector.
So I'm going to give that to you, if that's okay with my colleagues.
Yes.
And then you can kind of manage that through the finance team. Fruit Street? What's Fruit Street is this? Is that the Fruit Street Development Committee?
I think the reference here is to the Fruit Street property in general, where we have the DPW, we have the park and rec projects, potentially affordable housing. Now we also have the platform.
Yeah, and we're going to leave that with you, I think, for right now. That makes sense. Lake Maspinock Dam Advisory Committee.
Again, town manager, but I'm delegating that over to public works director.
That's fine. Everybody okay? Hopkinton Cultural Council. Mr. Sestari. Elementary School Building Committee. Mr. Ted Stone. Upper Charles Trail Committee. Mr. Catino.
John Catino. Yeah.
Open Space Preservation Commission. appointed board and committee memberships. Hold on a second. Mr. Kamalo, the Hopkinton Cultural Council, Mr. Starry's on that. The Elementary School Building Committee, so this is one you're on.
Yes.
Okay. So the Upper Trails Committee is Mr. Catino. The Open Space Preservation Commission, 5-year term, expires. I'm thinking I'm getting confused, the CPC.
No.
I'm sorry. Okay. So that, Mr. Ted Stone, is a committee where you go.
Yeah.
You're a voting member.
Yep.
You okay with that?
Yep.
So that is one where you would attend as an actual member.
Yep.
Sustainable Green Committee.
Again, for the benefit of the new members, this is a committee that has not been functioning. The two members that you saw today have basically been acting as the advisory team to Dave Del Torio, the town engineer.
Well, if it's not functioning, then I'll take it.
Brent.
All right, let's just leave that one, Mr. Kamalo. It sounds a little odd. Affordable Housing Trust Fund. Mr. Sestari. Marathon Fund Committee. Mr. Catino.
Yeah.
Metro West Regional Rant Transit Authority. So I'm the member of that authority. We actually met yesterday. Hopkinton 2020 representative. Mr. Catino.
Catino.
And Charter Review Committee, Mr. Sestari.
Yep. Yep.
So does everybody everybody feel good about that?
Yes.
I didn't check the numbers, just kind of eyeballing it. It looks pretty reasonable. I have a few less, but trust me, I have a lot more day to day as the chair. But are you comfortable, Mr. Tedstone?
Yep.
Mrs. Wright, you feel good about that?
Yeah, I think I'm getting off easy, but that's fine. Works for me.
And the role of liaison, everybody understands at least. I mean, you can make it what you want. You can, you're individually elected members, you can do what you want. But I have seen in the past, and I learned the hard way, that I said, oh, I will do it all for you. And then my first term, I was just going round and round and merry-go-round, and it was tough at home and elsewhere. Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to appoint the liaison positions as determined this evening. That's it. That's what I would entertain.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? One quick point. So for all the assignments that each of us has to those chairs and those committees that are out there in the community that this represents, we are here for you. We are happy to help any way we can. If you need us, please reach out to us, because we've got a lot going in the community. We don't know necessarily everything that's going on with all of these. If you need us, please do reach out, and we'll be happy to come and listen and learn. Okay? All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Okay, so we have liaisons set up for this year. That's not appointments, by the way. Appointments is a different matter. So these are our liaisons to the committees and things like that. Appointments are where all the people are serving in the community right now that this board appoints, which is a lot. We do that right after the first. We'll do that in the July meeting, correct? I think we have to do that in the July meeting because the new fiscal year begins. It's kind of like this. We just go through it. Now, in the past, there have been some situations that have arisen where some members are concerned that somebody shouldn't continue for whatever reason, and that gets a little dicey.
Yep.
But in general, we just kind of go down like we did here. But that's not what we did tonight, so there could be some confusion perhaps with some of the constituents. Okay. Next item on the agenda, Mr. Kamalo, town manager's report. Okay. I don't see liaison reports here because we just did liaison assignments. Just a real quick liaison report. I was at the Metro West Regional Transit Authority meeting yesterday. It went very well. The MWRTA is really a growing organization in Metro West. We've got service now in Milford. It's brand new. There's service in Weston, there's service in Wellesley. You can jump on a bus in Hopkinton, and you can be in 24 hours in China if you want.
and never touch a car or a cab. So that's a great launching point with the MWRTA. You can get the shops, you can get the malls. It really is a great organization. I enjoy very much serving on that board, and more to come there. Mrs. Wright.
Just a comment that you might, a feedback you might give back to them. I was told by the Senior Center that even though their primary focus is the seniors, there are a number of disabled residents in the town. There are quite a number over at the Wood Partners apartment development. For any of their transportation needs, they are consistently calling on the Senior Center and their van services to provide disabled transportation. And there is a serious need in the town or within Metro West for some kind of transportation arrangements for the disabled, because the Senior Center simply can't handle it.
That's an excellent point. It is something that Mr. Kamalo, myself, as the board member and the administrator of the MWRTA, met probably a month or two back now and talked about that very need. And, you know, there's the T has the ride.
Right.
And the MWRTA has a similar service, and we're working on bringing that to Hopkinton. So right. It's on the list.
So it's okay. A gap.
Other than that, I don't have any other liaisons that I had from last year to report on anyway. Okay. Any future board agenda items? Mr. Tedstone.
Nothing future. I'd just like to say that I did take part in that Fireman Sunday memorial celebration last week. And that was always a pretty good, moving tribute to some of the fallen Hopkinton firefighters in the past.
Okay, great. Thank you. Mrs. Wright, any future board agenda items?
Not tonight.
There is a groundbreaking ceremony for the fabulous, awesome new boulevard we have now in Hopkinton, down right off 495. I'm going to be attending that in the morning. I'm not sure if you folks are or not. If you're there, great. We'll say hello then. But other than that, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved. Second.
So moved and second.
Discussion. All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Good night, everybody.